Good morning and welcome to the 24th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. And before we begin, can I please ask people to ensure that all electronic devices are switched to silent. This morning we have apologies from Eleanor Whittam and Beatrice Wishart, and I welcome Christine Graham and Liam MacArthur as substitutes. Our first item of business is an evidence session with representatives of the salmon farming industry as part of our follow-up inquiry into salmon farming in Scotland. And this morning, I welcome to the meeting Dr. Ralph Birkerdyke, Head of Fish Health from the Scottish Sea Farms, David Brown, the Shetland Seawater Manager from Cook Scotland, Ben Hadfield, the Chief Operating Officer from Farming Scotland, Ireland, Faroes and Atlantic Canada, from Maui, Scotland, Kimberly McKinnell, the Head of Health from Bakkafrost, Scotland, Constance Patillo, Head of Farming Operations, Wester Ross Salmon, and Tavish Scott, Chief Executive of Salmon Scotland. And also welcome to the meeting Edward Mountain, who will be taking part in the discussion. So before we can begin, can I ask each of the panellists to briefly introduce themselves, and if you can keep your introduction just to your name and your role, everyone will have plenty of opportunity to add further as the members start to ask questions. I'll start with David Brown and move anti-clockwise. David.
Yeah, no, thanks very much for having me along this morning. I'm David Brown, the Shetland Seawater Manager for Cook Scotland, looking after all the production that we do in the Shetland Islands.
I'm Constance Patillo. I work up at West Ross Fisheries in Ullapool, and prior to that I was working out in the Western Isles as an area manager out there.
Morning and thanks for having us here. My name is Kimberly McKinnell, the Head of Health for Bakkafrost Scotland, covering seawater and freshwater farming across our estate.
Morning, Gavina. Morning, colleagues. Tavish Scott, Chief Executive of Salmon Scotland, and thank you for your words about Beatrice Wishart. I mean, I think a lot of us are thinking about her at this time.
Absolutely. Good morning. Again, thank you for the invite. I'm Ben Hadfield. I work for Maui. I'm responsible for Scotland, Ireland, Faroes and Atlantic Canada.
Good morning. My name is Ralph Birkerdyke. I'm Head of Fish Health and Welfare for Scottish Sea Farms, with oversight of both strategic and operational matters regarding fish health and welfare from egg through to harvest for the last 8 years in Scottish Sea Farms, and prior to that working in the industry in total for 23 years.
Okay, thank you. Now, just before we move on, I'm aware that I didn't ask Edward Mount for his declaration of interest. Edward.
Thank you very much, Convener, and I'd like to remind the committee that my interests in salmon fishing on the River's Bay are declared in my register of interest. It employs three people, and it's been in the family ownership for over 73 years. And I don't believe it is directly affected by fish farms because it's on the east coast of Scotland, not the west coast, where most of the fish farms are currently located. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. Did you wish to declare any interest?
I don't believe I have any relevant interest to today's proceedings.
Okay, we'll kick off with questions. We're aiming to finish approximately 11 o'clock. So, over the last week, the industry has been accused in the media. That prior to the committee's visit, that the fish farm we visited tried to hide the truth and paint an inaccurate picture of the salmon farming industry when the committee visited. So one of the main issues was the quantity of dead fish that were removed or allegedly removed prior to the visit. Can you set out just what the quantity of dead fish were removed the morning prior to the visit, and also the weight removed from the pen at Dunstaffnage, which was shown in the video footage. Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Convener. I'm happy to take that directly, and Ralph would obviously be appropriate to take Ralph on that, given his responsibilities at Scottish Sea Farms, and we appreciate the opportunity to respond to last week's events and indeed the BBC reporting of that, and Ralph will want to share his perspective on that. This committee and our sector have been subjected to a deliberate, orchestrated and coordinated campaign by anti-salmon farming extreme activists, aided and abetted by some in the media. This is an obvious and deliberate attempt to derail this committee's focus on what has changed in Scotland's salmon farming sector since 2018. I refer the committee to the comments on the BBC website yesterday, which has extensive quotes again from an anti-salmon farming activist and their objectives. Now, no member of this committee can be in any doubt as to the motives of these extreme activists. Now, we deplore that, and we are very sorry that the committee members have been used in this way. Our people, our men and women who work in our companies and our extensive supply chain businesses from Unst in the north all the way down to your home in the south of Scotland, convener, should not have to put up with this behaviour. It's not only us, from government ministers and civil servants and our regulators who regularly are assailed with abuse and intimidatory tactics from extreme activists. These people would not just shut down Scotland's salmon farming sector, but they would shut down farming as well. Read their website, read their tweets. So we would ask this committee today to call out that behaviour. If Parliament wants a sector that employs 12,000 people in areas where well-paid work is not so easily found, where our average salary is £36,000 a year, and we produce a great fish that is sought after in 50 countries around the world, now would be a very helpful time to do that. Now, the Fish Health Inspectorate, the government's own regulator, wrote to your committee convener on Friday, and they said two things that I think are important in the context of the question you asked. Firstly, the Fish Health Inspectorate do not have concerns with the routine mortality removal procedure being undertaken in the video footage. That's not me saying it, it's the Fish Health Inspectorate saying it. And in addition, Charles Allen, the Fish Health Inspectorate, gave you evidence in June on mortality more generally, and I know the committee will have rested on that. And secondly, the letter said, and I quote, the FHI, the Fish Health Inspectorate, would consider that this procedure would be consistent with the mortality removal procedures on Scottish aquaculture farm sites, although the procedures may differ between sites, which is self-evidently the case. Ralph, would that be an appropriate moment to let you talk exactly to the convener's points?
Yeah, just to clarify on the situation, so on Monday the 23rd, video footage was published via media organisations of daily husbandry procedures, activities taking place at our farm Dunstaffnage, which occurred from the Saturday the 21st of October. This included the daily routine procedure of removal of mortalities, which we do every day when possible for each of the net enclosures on that farm. This is typically done in the morning as best practice for biosecurity and as a predator control measure to protect from seals. There was no attempt whatsoever to cover up. There was no special treatment for the visit. We do this as a routine every day. Any such claims which have been made by the anti-fish farming campaigners was incorrect, misleading for sensationalist reporting by media organisations. The number of dead fish found in each pen will vary from day to day and between pens based on a variety of factors, such as differences in health status, predation pressures and changes in tidal currents, which can prevent dead fish from moving to the collecting basket at the bottom of the net. For pen 1, which was in the video, there was 250 fish recovered that day, whereas fewer fish were removed from the other pens. The total mortality rate recovered that day was 0.1% of the farm population of 448,509 fish. The total mortality rate for the last week, for within that week, which was last week, was 0.29% in total. This is well below the 1% threshold for notifying FHI of mortality events. Therefore, there was categorically no mass mortality event, as published by some media organisations, being misleading and sensationalist. The fish in Pen 1 had been treated with fresh water on a wellboat 3 days previously to the weekend. Unfortunately, any handling event of farm animals increases the risk of mortality following that handling. We, like any farmer, do everything we can to minimise this, but it is regretfully the reality of farming, which is why we are so concerned about the sea lice risk framework proposals by CEPA, where we will be obliged to intervene or treat our fish at low lice burdens, not for the welfare needs of our fish, but for a potential risk to wild salmon. The negative result of this increased requirement for interventions on fish welfare can be clearly expected and will result in negative impact on farm fish welfare, increasing the risk of transfer of disease and increased mortality rates, thereby causing reputational damage to the sector and Scotland PLC. Overall, we are very disappointed that the anti-fish farming campaign group deliberately tried to influence the important fact-finding work that this committee was trying to do. And we hope the committee will see it for what it was, an attempt to create misinformation to sensationalise what are actually daily husbandry activities by our hard-working farmers.
Thank you. Just to tease one or two things out there to get clarity. So you suggested that from one pen there was 250 fish removed, but that didn't meet the quantity which met the voluntary mortality reporting threshold. Thank you. Would the 250 for that site be exceptionally high or unusually low on average?
It would be typical of following a treatment like a handling event as we discussed. So for that individual pen, it was slightly higher than normal, but it was not exceptional. No.
Okay, thank you. And just final for me, would the removal, you say it's part of the everyday management, removing the dead fish. Would the removal of dead fish in that manner be carried out before an inspection from the Fish Health Inspectorate, or would the Fish Health Inspectorate be there to inspect the removal to confirm farm mortality rates?
Most Fish Health inspections occur from the start of the day, so from 8 o'clock starting on from shore base. So no, typically mortality removal isn't carried out before that. If obviously the inspection occurs in the afternoon, yes, then that practice would have taken place on that farm as routine.
Okay, and in your experience, how often has the Fish Health Inspectorate been on site when dead fish have been removed from a pen?
Personally, I wouldn't be able to answer that. I'd have to ask my colleagues who have been on farm when FHI have been there, or we could ask for FHI to respond on that matter.
There's frequent visits from FHI, and they come on the sites as their will is. So within the course of the year, they'll witness many routine mortality removals. Just a point to add to what Ralph said is the Scottish Salmon Sector publishes all mortality monthly through its own website, as well as the recording thresholds to FHI.
Okay, thank you. Did anyone else want to come in?
No, I was just going to say, convener, to Ben's last point, we publish, no other salmon farming nation in the world publish on that basis. I hope the committee finds that reassuring. And no, indeed, as we all know from other walks of life, do other agricultural sectors either in terms of mortality. So we are and have been very transparent on this for a very long time.
Would it be a regular occurrence for the Fish Health Inspectorates to arrive prior to dead fish being removed? Is that something you experience? Because we're interested on how random or unannounced the Fish Health Inspectorate visits are. What's a normal routine in a normal month or a normal year? How often would the Fish Health Inspectorates actually carry out an unannounced visit that might take in the time of the day when dead fish will be removed from a pen? Ben?
Yeah, so as I said before, it is fairly routine, so you should expect 2 to 3 times a year that they would visit sites, often with short notice. It's not that there's no notice, because they use our equipment, such as boats and larger vessels, to get out to the sites. In addition to that, where there is elevated mortality, for whatever reason, whether it's disease or treatment losses, then they'll follow up higher levels of mortality. So they very often try and get to the sites when the mortality has been removed, because they want to inspect the fish and they want to take samples. And there's actually quite a degree of co-working, because fish farmers are interested to find out what the disease status is or what the health status of the fish all the time. So samples will often be taken in duplicate and sometimes together.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to make the point that the handling of mortalities, which is animal byproducts, that's covered under specific legislation. So all of the paperwork associated with that, from the recovery, the actual quantities, are fully recorded, and they're fully audited and inspected by both FHI, but also by other organisations, so including AFA. So I think that's also should be bear in mind.
Thank you. Christine Graham.
Understand. I really do want to understand. Pen 1, Monday the 23rd, 250 fish were removed. Is that correct? What percentage is that of Pen 1 on that day? Thank you. And the second thing is, on when you're given notice of a visit, and I understand most of them you're given notice of a visit from an inspectorate, how much notice are you given?
Typically, it's depending on the location. So if it's a routine visit, so it's not a diagnostic visit, then it could be more than a week, 10 days, because often, say these locations are in the Northern Isles, the time would be required for the FHI to arrange travel. If it's a diagnostic visit, we could be given less than 24 hours notice.
Could you just explain to the difference between routine and diagnostic, please?
So it's probably more a question for FHI, but so they will be carrying out routine visits and inspections to cover certain legislative requirements on a risk-based assessment of fish health situations, or sorry, fish health status of the fish on each of these farms, as they do for oysters and mussels and other aquaculture species as well. So that's as routine. So some farms will have a routine visit every year. Other farms will maybe have a visit every year and a half or 2 years based on that situation. So that's a routine, and they're auditing or inspecting against the legislation that exists. A diagnostic visit is in response to increased mortality on the farm, where they would then contact the business and to arrange to come out to that farm. And as I say, that can be as little as less than 24 hours notice. I've been contacted before on an afternoon, and they were there on site at 8 a.m. the next day.
Thank you.
So completely unannounced.
Thank you.
Emma Roddick.
But I think Ralph did also hint that that's one of many audits, and you may be coming on to this in terms of your questions, is one of many audits that our sea farms see all the time. There's 1,000 audits a year on 210 farms, so we're not lacking audit in that sense, if that helps Christine Graham with that context. Absolutely. Yeah.
Thank you. Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. Can I firstly ask, with regards to Pen 1, what was the survival rate before and after the removal that was covered in the media?
I don't have that to hand, so I'd have to come back to you with the detail on that. I can say that the site is currently standing at 97% survival.
Okay. Was
97% in total.
Was it a concern before that day?
No, it was not.
And it's not now?
No, it wasn't. That mortality, the level of mortality saw on that day was similar to what we saw from the other pens that we were treated with fresh water prior to that. So okay. This is why I go back to our concern about the potential for being pushed into requirement to treat when it's not for the welfare interests of the fish.
So far today, we've heard the removal that was covered in the media and in the video as routine, typical, not exceptional. Now, if that number of fish being removed in the morning is so unexceptional as to not be worth mentioning after lunchtime, is that an industry which can be described as sustainable and that puts welfare of the animals as a priority?
Well, let me start with that, Ms. Roddick. I mean, there are 70 million fish in the sea at any one particular time around in Scotland's sea pens, and Ralph's describing how many? 210, and he's described exactly the percentage, and he answered Christine Graham's question about the absolute percentage. So I think it does need to be seen in the context of the overall number. Our objective is to reduce mortalities at every possible opportunity, and I know you and others asked questions of Ralph's colleagues on the sea farm that last Monday about that. So you heard them answer those questions at that time. But to your broad point, we absolutely strive to reduce mortality in every way we do. And all of our fish farmers, David could speak to that, as could Connie, as could all of our panel.
Can I bring David in at this point and then Ben?
Yeah, sorry. Thanks very much.
I think that it's very important to say about the care we have for the animals that we look after. I mean, from a very personal level, I've been a crofter my whole life. I've looked after animals. I've looked after sheep, cows, hens, whatever, and that extends on to fish. And I think that an awful lot of all of our staff have a caring for the animals that we look after. We do not want dead fish on our sites at all. We do not seek to have mortalities. We want to give the best care we have to our fish at all times, and that goes for absolutely everybody. Nobody wants to go in the morning to take dead fish out of a cage at all. It's not good for the company, it's not good for staff. It's not a very nice job, and we'd much rather not do it. So I think there really needs to be a realisation that there's a huge number of people out there who really do care about animals that are, or the fish that are swimming around on the fish farms in Scotland.
Ben.
I think it's wrong to describe that the mortality was unremarkable. It occurred after a treatment for amoebic gill disease, which is something that came into Scotland in 2011 and 12. And what it's meant, it's ubiquitous within the environment. It was in Ireland before then. As the temperatures have warmed, it's come into Scotland. So you do have to take the fish into a wellboat and treat them with fresh water. And in simple terms, what that does is it bursts the amoebic cell that's living on the gills, and it's a treatment for the fish which makes them more healthy. But a handling event will increase mortality to the levels that you've seen. In terms of mortality within salmon, you know, you've got to remember that in biological terms we call these R strategists. The female salmon produces 10 to 15,000 eggs. You know, they externally fertilise these eggs. They're open to the environment, and they have a mortality level that's not comparable with poultry, chickens, beef. And you see, Edward struggles with this a little bit as a beef farmer, so just to spend a bit more time on it, if I may. 15,000 eggs from an adult salmon compared to 36 piglets from a pig, or 240 eggs or one calf. And to compare the two is not correct. You know, we have other species which have much higher levels of mortality in the marine fish farming sector. And so for us, getting mortality down to zero is a strong aspiration, and we do everything we can to achieve that. But you will have a mortality range in farmed salmon between 10 and 25%, depending on the environment you're farming within.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear Tavish Scott mentioned the questions that were posed on site, because I certainly did ask quite a few questions around mortality, and as I say, the removal that morning was not mentioned. And what I would be keen to understand is how many dead fish is a concern, and at what point is an investigation or further checks on how the salmon died merited?
Well, any dead fish is a concern, but I think what we're describing is context, yeah, and numbers, and we'll not repeat them all again, but I think you've heard the answer in terms of the context. But Ben and Ralph are also crucially describing to you that when interventions are forced upon us by the introduction of regulation, and Rachel Hamilton actually asked this question at an earlier session back in June, she put her finger right on this point, the increased level of interventions that are not justified in veterinary terms, in terms of looking after a fish, can lead to increased mortality. That's a challenge for us, and we have that robust discussion with regulators all the time. So this is always a trade-off, but the fundamental point is obviously that we're trying to reduce mortality, as Ben has just said, to zero. That is our absolute objective as a sector.
So what is the trigger point for sending fish off for further investigation?
Sorry, what kind of investigation do you mean?
To find out how it died.
Ralph?
Yeah, it's more about seeing the increase in rate of mortality that would then instigate a follow-up diagnostic visit by health professionals. Obviously, if it gets beyond the 1% per week, which is the FHI threshold for weekly reporting, then there's a clear defined threshold there. But for us personally, it rises above 0.5% within a week.
Okay.
So, but can I just to respond to your earlier question? Is that okay? I understand that during the visit, I wasn't there myself, unfortunately, but I understand that the group had to be separated up because of numbers in terms of boats. And my colleagues have assured me that actually there was communications about what the daily routines were on mortality removal and moribund removal. So I'm sorry if that didn't take place with yourselves, but I understand that did take place with the... We did try to communicate everything that we do to the committee.
Mm-hmm. I can confirm that.
Thank you.
Mortality rate. The Fish Health Inspectorate's letter to the committee describes a mortality rate from that week of 0.55%. Now, is that based on your 447,563 fish or the initial stock?
That week hadn't finished by the time they wrote that letter. So, unfortunately, that 0.55%, I don't think that's from that week. I don't have it in front of me, I'm sorry. I think we need to clarify that.
Okay.
The weekly mortality, because they sent the letter, I believe, on the 27th.
Yeah, right.
So that was before the end of the week finished. So that reporting week is a Monday to Sunday. reporting week. So, and as I said earlier, the mortality rate there was 0.29% for the week.
Okay, well, would the 0.29% be based on initial stock or your stock that week?
Of the week, yes, as of starting opening count on Monday.
Okay, so it's...
So it would include the mortality from the Monday.
Right. OK, that's me.
I've got three other members wish to come in. I just want to clarify something because I think it's quite important. You mentioned the fresh water treatment and delousing was mentioned and also treatment for gill disease. Can you tell us exactly what those processes entail and what actually happened? What was the fresh water treatment prior to the visit? Was it a delousing? Was it a gill disease treatment, because that's unclear.
Okay, sorry. Yes, so for that that pen, it was fresh water for AGD, for treating of the gills, but we also used what is now commonplace is to utilise a de-icing technology called FLS, which is where the fish, after they've been treated with the fresh water for the gills in the wellboat, they then pass through this, it's in-water jets of water to dislodge lice off, any lice that may be present on the fish, off their skin, which then they, before they return back to the pen. And we're doing this now so that we can actually, this is a welfare improvement, a significant welfare improvement, because by doing only one handling event, whereas prior to that we would potentially have had to do two, one to treat for the gills, maybe with that fresh water or otherwise, and also then to potentially do a lousing treatment or a veterinary medicine treatment separately. So we're able to do this, to do that, to achieve the outcome of that with just one handling event, so which is much positive for welfare. But I don't know if any other of my colleagues wish to comment on freshwater treatments as well with others.
Kimberly.
Yeah, just to give a bit more of a broader view on welfare in general, what we're talking about here is fairly reactive issues, but we've made fundamental changes to our welfare practices over the last 5 years, moving more into a proactive and preventative means of looking after our fish. And this is a complete change in how we manage the health of our animals. We're using more and more novel technologies for monitoring the fish. So we're talking about identifying and investigating mortalities at the point of the fish dying. But actually, in advance of any of these issues occurring, you know, we're taking blood biomarkers, for example. And this is the same as when you go to the doctor and get a blood panel. We know if there's liver damage, we know if there's damage to the gills in advance of some of these handling events. So we have a really good view of what the health of the fish are like well in advance of these handling events. We're doing regular welfare assessments. So we're looking at the physical condition of the fish, analysing this data and making some assessments on how these handling events will be tolerated. And we're monitoring the fish in all sorts of different ways, so using cameras, obviously daily observations by our staff, to really get a good view of what the health and welfare is like long before we have to go in with a treatment wellboat. As Ralph mentioned, these vessels are state-of-the-art. You know, they're built with welfare at the highest priority, so from the pipes and pumps that take the fish on board to the holding wells, everything is thought for the best welfare of the fish. And these really are a game changer in terms of health and welfare, managing two different parasite issues at the same time, which is a long distance away from where we were 5 years ago.
Thank you. Constance.
I just wanted to touch on a farm level in terms of welfare, based on what the farmers are doing. So the farmers are out every day assessing the welfare of these fish. They're looking at them, whether it's through cameras, through visual inspections. And every week, we're taking small samples from these pens and assessing them visually, looking at lice counts, looking at gill health, looking at physical condition. And these are very well-trained farmers, skilled farmers, out in these rural communities that take this very seriously. As David mentioned, you know, farmers, they're passionate about what they do, they care about what they do, and they want to see the salmon thrive. So it's at the forefront of their mind, and we put in daily practices to check the health and welfare of the fish. And they're out in all kinds of weather, no matter what, on a horrible, wet, rainy day, when you would consider, would we go out? We would go out, and we're checking those fish because it is so important, and it's fundamental to how we farm salmon.
I've got questions from Emma, Ariane, Rachel, and then Rhoda. Emma.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, everybody. I think you answered the question about triggering numbers, because we saw what externally looked like a healthy fish, gills looked okay, and there was no sea lice. So externally, this was a fish that looked okay. So it was, I guess the question is, what is the trigger number of moribund fish that are pulled out in order to then further investigate what might be the cause of death? That was my question.
I mean, it's really about the increase. So we don't expect to see, we hope not to see, moribund fish. So moribund fish being poorly fished, which, you know, are which you would remove from the net pen environment to then humanely cull. That would, if you see an increase of that on a farm, as you would with, unfortunately, seeing sheep with lame on in a field or something, if you start to see increasing numbers that are above a background level, then that would stimulate a health visit. Mortality itself, as we spoke about earlier, there may be different thresholds and different producers, but it's really about seeing that upward trajectory. It's a bit like the same as for amoebic gill disease, where every week we're taking gill swabs from salmon on our farms, each of our farms, to send away for PCR analysis, like we all did with the COVID, the pandemic. And we're using that information, analysing that information to inform us, have an early, more informed position on when to actually be able to go into it to treat at the right time, to prevent any negative welfare situations if you don't catch it in time. So we're using all of these latest technologies, including also AI technology on with cameras, subsurface feed cameras, where we're scanning fish for, it's just in the early days trialling, I should say, or evaluation, but scanning for potential skin lesions as an indicator of maybe bacterial disease, looking for, also it's able to assess maturation rates as well. All of this information, all of these welfare indicators, we're taking into our internal database systems and analysing them to then follow up then with if we need to. In an ideal world, you'd put your smolt into a farm and you wouldn't need to touch them or see them, you know, other than feed them, obviously, until harvest. But, you know, that unfortunately isn't the reality of farming.
AI technology helps reduce stress because you're not handling the salmon?
Exactly, it would do. It does. But we still, we're still required on a weekly basis to take fish out of the water to do these assessments, particularly for sea lice. But also for gills, regardless of the requirement for sea lice, we would still need to visually inspect gills. The AI cameras, they can't assess gills because obviously they're covered by the gill covers.
Okay. David and Connie could both speak to practically what fish farmers do every week in terms of looking at fish in terms of health. Would you want to just describe what that looks like?
Absolutely. I think it's very important to say that there's constant monitoring going on fish, both as Ralph says, through cameras and that, and also by the skill of the stock people on our sites. There's an awful lot being spoken about reacting to dead fish. We don't want these fish to die in the first place. So we'd rather get them better before that ever happens. And that's what we seek to do. And the monitoring we're doing on the fish, we're physically sampling fish out of the cages, I mean, 10 fish per cage per week for cook on every site. And that's to give a very good overview of the gills. We'll also look at sea lice at the same time. So there's constant monitoring, as well as that we're monitoring feeding behaviour on the fish. We're always looking at how the fish are reacting in the cages to whatever is going on in the environment. And I believe it's that early intervention. We're not necessarily looking for dead fish to create a health visit on our sites. We're looking for a change in anything on the sites to trigger that visit. And it's that early visit. It's the skill of the stock people who work for us. Who really make the difference. We may think we're important sitting up here, but the really important people in the company are the people working day to day on the sites who notice there is a change in behaviour in the fish. We notice it early and we prevent those fish from dying in the first place.
Thanks.
Thank you. Besides that, mortality is a very crude indicator of fish welfare, so we don't use that as the trigger, as David has really well covered this very well. You know, many of the farms will be carrying out welfare assessments on the fish that they're actually checking, which is sedated fish, anaesthetised fish, not only for lice, for gills, but also for a range of welfare indicators of morphological changes. And this has occurred since a landmark publication by peer-reviewed publication on operational welfare indicators, which came out through collaboration between Scotland and in Norway and other parties. So we're now doing this as routine. For many of us, it'll be 10 fish per pen per farm every single week. And we're analysing that information to track to see where any subtle changes in those start to occur. This may indicate a negative welfare direction. So then we do intervene and with a diagnostic follow-up. To wait till mortality is not where we would be.
Ali-Anne Burgess.
Thanks, Commissioner. I've just got a couple of clarifying questions. I think, Ralph, in your kind of statement, I think in response to the convener, you mentioned that Pen 1 was treated. Am I correct?
That's correct, yes. Yeah. The previous week, yeah.
And so Pen 1 was treated, but I think there were 7 pens there?
Correct.
So why was only one pen treated? That we went to visit?
The previous pens have been treated earlier. So that was the last pen to be treated on that farm.
Okay, we kind of understand that there's something that happens that triggers that lice gill health, so and so forth, morphological changes, something like that. So what was the process? The 7 pens were treated over what period of time?
The 7 pens, they started to be treated on the 2nd of September. The other pens are through to the 9th of September. What we were actually doing was also doing something called a split down, which is where half of the fish were being removed, a scheduled treatment and scheduled split down, where half of the fish then, you take the fish on board a well boat and you are treating them with fresh water for their gills. Because seasonally, this is when, this is the current time when AGD, amoebic gill disease, becomes more prevalent because of seawater temperature, predominantly. Okay. So this is typically when most farms will be treating most of their fish if required for amoebic gill disease. So at that time we'd take advantage of doing that one handling event to split down the fish, so where you take half the fish and put them into a different farm, and keeping 50% remaining on that farm. And this is a typical practice what one does in order to manage the fish better. So, and at the same time, as I said, we carried out the freshwater treatments.
Okay.
And that one pen, it was attempted to treat the week before the final treatment, but it had to be abandoned due to the weather. So hence its actual treatment was on the 3 days prior to the, I think it was on the Friday.
Okay.
Friday
Thanks
the 20th.
Thanks very much
Three
for
days
that.
Prior to the visit.
Thank you. And then, Ben, you were talking about the daily... Oh, not Ben, David Brown. Hello, good to see you again. You were talking about the daily routine and you mentioned that 10 fish are taken. Is that from a whole farm or per cage?
That was a weekly figure, sorry.
Weekly figure.
Per cage, per site.
Per cage, per site.
Yes.
And in each cage, what's the stocking density? So 10 fish out of how many?
10 fish, sorry.
Out of how many fish in a cage?
Basically, the number of fish in a cage, will certainly range. But I think that gives a very good overview based on the number of fish we have in our cages.
And what kind of range would we be looking at in terms of numbers of fish inside the cage?
Well, it very much depends. There are different numbers of fish in cages due to the size of the cages and the depth of the nets, so it can range quite a lot. I mean, I don't think it's relevant, really, how many fish are in the cage. The stocking density is the same throughout, basically. We will treat, if the cage is bigger, we will stock it to a level where the stocking density will not go above a certain level.
Okay, I appreciate you don't think it's relevant, but I'm curious and interested to understand what the stocking density would be on an average range.
Well, the stocking density in an early part of fish's life will obviously be very low, but on a site average, we wouldn't go above 15.
15?
Cubic kilograms per cubic metre, which is equivalent to, it's quite important, that's when you think of a cubic metre of water, it's 98.5% water. 1.5% fish.
Okay, and just figures.
That would be at the peak. Sorry.
Okay, so and at peak, that 15 square cubic meters would end up being how many fish?
How many fish? Well, it would vary. Like I say, it varies.
At their largest size, say.
At the largest pen size for us, up to say about probably 40,000.
40,000 yeah. fish. Okay. Thanks.
But that would vary much.
Yeah, I understand that. Thanks.
Can I bring Ben in?
Yeah, so I think I'm not trying to totally preempt the question or dive into the question, but you're asking if 10 fish is representative of the entire population, and statistically, is that valid? So we've studied that with academia over many years, and statistically, it is valid. If you were looking for the onset of sea lice or the onset of AGD, you may go much further. 10 is an absolute minimum, and that could happen a couple of times a week. But if you're looking for very low levels of AGD, it would be commonplace to sample a couple of hundred fish because you're looking for the very early signs of it. And then, as Ralph said, you're testing it with PCR testing, which picks up whether the DNA of the parasite is there. Scotland has perhaps the lowest stocking density, excluding Ireland, worldwide. So you should think that generally the average stocking density in salmon farms is about 7 or 8 kilos per cube. So less than 1% fish, 99% water, and the fish are free to move around in the pen. So on organic production, which is fairly niche in Scotland, represents no more than 10%, then it's 10 kilos a cube. The maximum stocking density is 15 kilos a cube on standard production, but any one pen can be up to 17. But these
cube, is that you're saying cubic
yeah,
meter?
Sorry,
I'm really grateful when you actually unpack acronyms jargon. That'd be really helpful.
So per meter cubed, and you know, please don't forget how big these pens are. In a 160 meter pen, you can fit 7 A380s. In these kind of pens, you know, in a 200-metre pens, so several A380s. So it's just the scale, aircraft, it's the scale of these pens, which is enormous.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Thank you. A supplement from Rachel Hamilton and then Rhoda Grant.
Yeah, can I just, I think it was Ralph that talked about this. No, it was Ben, you look relieved then, Ralph. On the freshwater treatment, is it normal for that to look at the weeks that we've seen between weeks 36 and 37 where that freshwater treatment had occurred for the mortality rate to increase? I mean, it doubled in this circumstance. It was still 0.24 to 0.55, but overall, in terms of industry, what kind of percentage are we looking at?
I mean, neither Ralph's company or my company would reschedule or stop a treatment because you were visiting. That is an important visit, you're important people, but if we didn't treat the fish for AGD, then it would progressively get worse, they would stop feeding, and then the mortality rate would elevate significantly. You know, and the idea that this is caused by the number of fish in the pens or the scale of fish farming, that's completely incorrect. This is caused by the winter temperature in Scotland not going down to a level where AGD has become part of the environment. So it happens in Tasmania and it happens in Ireland, and it's happened really in Scotland since 2012. So in simple terms, if we don't treat the fish at least every 3 to 4 weeks in the height of summer, then mortality will increase. So you have to treat them to maintain good welfare. The industry has invested enormous amounts of capital investment and operating costs in well boats. So these well boats cost about £25,000 a day. My company has 3 or 4. Ralph's company has 2 or 3. So these have come in to the industry. And what they do is hold the fish in fresh water, which kills all the amoeba. And then that weakens the sea lice and kills some of the sea lice. And then they put them through, they pressurise the well, so they gently go out of the well boat, and then they remove sea lice, filter the sea lice so they don't go into the environment, and put the fish back.
Roughly how many salmon would you be putting through the well boat? And roughly, I mean, obviously, in commercial interests, you'd want as many to survive as possible. But I presume there's been work done on the process of this. You were saying that, you know, you wanted to go for... this is kind of seems to be reactive to me, which is what Kimberly was talking about. They're looking at more of a preventative, proactive agenda. But what survival rate do you want from that? What can you expect when you're carrying this process out?
Yeah, so prior to AGD becoming an issue in Scotland, which, as I said, was 2011, 2012, then the mortality rates was typically around 15% over the cycle. The AGD pressure has elevated that, and you can see that over the cycle now the mortality can be as high as 25% or in individual cases higher. I'm talking about an average. So there's no other treatment for it really other than fresh water. You can use hydrogen peroxide, which is an oxidizing agent. It's water with an extra oxygen molecule on the end of it. What that does is make the shell of the amoeba like crispy so it breaks. But it's a lot of hydrogen peroxide, and a lot of people rightly class that in as a chemical in the sense that everything's a chemical. So to be proactive, we've upscaled the fleet significantly to tackle both sea lice together and amoebic gill disease. And this year you see that the mortality levels in Scottish salmon farming have dropped quite a lot over the summer period because, A, we've had a colder summer, and also the scale of the fleet that's doing this work has increased a lot, and it's taken many years to get that level of investment. So my company, which as of today has 40,700 tonnes in the sea, roughly, we would expect to have to treat most of that biomass in the height of summer every 3 to 4 weeks with fresh water. So it's this amazing logistical challenge.
Okay, for the out of that total then, what's your expected survival rate?
So in August we had about 1.4% mortality, which we consider to be a better year than the previous years that we've had. Mm. So we're starting to see, I think, that with a cooler summer and this move out of the El Nino conditions that we've been in, which causes warming in the Atlantic, so the environment's been a bit kinder. Also, we've upscaled the equipment and the boats to do this work. We're seeing lower mortality now due to gill disease.
Okay. Can I just ask one small question? David, there's been a lot of comparisons today with livestock farming, and I quite frankly can understand livestock farming more than I can aquaculture, because I grew up on a farm. But I was wondering what, when the Fish and Health Inspectorate talked about a farm management statement, what is a farm management statement?
A farm management statement is basically how we seek to operate the farms, how we work with our neighbours, and basically how we look after the health of the fish on the farm. Basically, what is our operating procedures on the farm?
And so, if there's a problem, and the Fish Health Inspectorate ask to contain, as this detail says, contain provision for the review of the document and the arrangements for sensitivity testing in relation to treatments for parasite management. Is that how Fish Health Inspectorate communicate, and they leave it up to you or the fish farms to actually carry out the work that is required, and then that farm management plan is then updated? What happens?
Sorry, you read the bit that you read out there was extremely fast, and I didn't quite pick it up.
Sorry, David. Okay, so the question was was given to the Fish Health Inspectorate: did any of these inspections identify any cause for concern or further regulatory action in relation to the particular farm that the committee visited? It says that the inspection identified that to ensure compliance with blah, 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 as amended, the farm management statement required to contain provision for the review of the document and the arrangements for sensitivity treatment in relation to treatments for parasite management. What is the process when there is an issue, and what happens with regards to the farm management statement?
I think if there is an issue on a site, then that would be reported to FHI, and there would be correspondence between us and them. I think we always seek to learn from anything we do, and if we saw as a result of any incident happening, an improvement could be made, that would be implemented by the companies.
But why do they mention the farm management statement? What is it about the farm management statement that they seem to rely on? And they say they give advice, they give a deadline, and then that you're asked to demonstrate compliance. But why did Ronald Smith from the FHI specifically mention the farm management statement?
So the farm management statement is it's a document which is the constituents of it, the contents of it are outlined in the Code of Good Practice. So when FHI come out to, when they visit a site to do an inspection, both a routine or a diagnostic, they will request to see the farm management statement, and this statement outlines what that farm does over these key areas of mainly biosecurity within that farm management area, and they'll then compare that with what they see on farm, such as mortality removal. The method of mortality removal, is that the same as it was described in that? Because the farm management statement should be updated and kept accurate at all times. So, and if there is any omissions or any differences, because things do change in terms of farming practices over time, then they will request that the farm management statement gets reviewed and updated if required for that.
Okay.
And a farm management statement could lead into a farm management agreement between different operators within the same farm management area.
Okay.
On a yearly basis.
Mm-hmm. By whom?
By the company.
Okay.
Rhoda Grant.
And inspector, sorry.
I'm going to move on. Rhoda.
I'm just listening to responses. I think it's clear that freshwater treatments have been a benefit, but I'm also picking up a wee bit of reluctance. I understand the handling of fish is an issue, but I'm picking up that there is some concern about possible future regulation about how that may be required to be carried out rather than carried out when the need arises.
Yes, I think, thank you to Rhoda Grant's question. Both Ralph and Ben have spoken to the sea lice framework and the extra regulation there and the implications of that. Gentlemen, do you want to just add to that?
I'll go first. So the development of freshwater treatment and the ability to filter and remove lice, that's accelerated in the last few years. And I don't like the word, but it is a game changer in terms of fish health. And it's very gentle. But whenever you handle fish, you'll always induce and cause some mortality during the crowd or the loading them onto the wellboat. So we try and avoid it. The new regulation which has come in from SEPA, the SEPA risk framework, what it's done is with a very high-level model which has a high degree of over-prediction. You know, it assumes all the farms in Scotland are at peak biomass at the same time, which doesn't happen. It doesn't make any allowances for the fact that farms use cleaner fish or other treatment strategies. And it doesn't model the specific characteristics of sea lice larvae. So it overpredicts significantly. But what it essentially says is out of 250 or so operational farms, only 19 of them have a theoretical concern or a potential hazard to wild fish, which is actually quite good. You know, it wasn't presented that way by activist community or even in the newspapers, but it's essentially saying that with a model that greatly overpredicts, We have no concern over the vast majority of the farms. And the 19 farms which are listed as potentially having an impact, and this is not causing mortality to wild fish, this is causing changes in behaviour to wild fish, like swimming speed, with a very conservative model. I think it's fair that you focus in on those farms and look at treatment methods and control. And most of them, by the way, are my company, so we'll have to deal with that and deal with that proactively. But what's been argued in multiple times in evidence given to this committee is that this model should become even more precautionary. It already massively overpredicts. It already exonerates most of the farms in terms of having a potential impact on wild fish. But the activist community and the fisheries interests are arguing for a model which is even more precautionary. You know, rather than validating that model and making it accurate. And that then is what Ralph is saying, that this is counterproductive to fish health, because we're grossly overpredicting the need to treat and handle fish. And this is pushing up mortality. And then the same people are creating this absolutely false narrative that mortality is occurring in the industry because we overproduce or we stock too much fish. That's how you go bankrupt as a fish farmer. You just don't do that. You don't do it in any livestock, and you certainly don't do it in salmon farming. So we're arguing really for a more science-based approach to take the precaution out of the model, make it very accurate, and then use it as a tool. And by the way, I'm a fan of the model. I think it's a good thing. But I don't think that niche activist groups should be allowed to force regulators to make a really inaccurate model and then force treatments. So I'm sorry about the length of that, convener, but it's important.
Thank you. I've got a brief supplementary from Christine Graham, who I think will be directed at Ralph. It's a specific question.
Oh, I don't know. It's just for clarity. In our briefing, it says, data published by Salmon Scotland shows that Dunstaffnage recorded a mortality rate of 56.5%. In its report of the same story, Scottish Sea Farms told The Guardian that this high mortality was a result of a micro jellyfish event, and mortality rate in the current production cycle was 3%. So just my question is quite simple. What is a production cycle? What was the production cycle? It was at 56.5%. And what is the production cycle that is now at 3%?
So they referred with the 56%, that was referring to the previous cycle of fish. So typically on a Atlantic salmon, farmed Atlantic salmon will be in the sea from input to harvest over an 18-month period.
That's 18 months. So what 18 months was that?
That would have been from the 22 generation. So I'd have to come back to you with the exact date of when they went to sea and when they were harvested. But so that was, they were not the same fish population that the committee saw last week.
No, that's what I'm trying to just want clarity. Yeah, so it's an 18-month period, which you're going to tell us, write to us,
correct.
And that period was 56.5%. That was invasion of, you say, of jellyfish or whatever. So what's the 3%? Is that the current one?
That's correct, yeah.
And that's for what period?
They went to sea in quarter one of this year through to present. They went to sea within quarter one of this year. The quarter one input, so they went. The smolt went to that farm. I'll have to come back to you with these.
It's just useful. Just want to know because I felt there wasn't any context to this, and I wanted to know the context. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Just
please, if I can, just expand on the further response that the detractors tried to use the unfortunately lower survival rate that we had in the previous cycle to influence the and have a more sensationalist story which they put out. I think it's really important that we do acknowledge the challenges that the sector had in 2022 and 2023 due to micro jellyfish. Prior to that, you know, we had we saw 2-3 years of La Nina climate change situation changed to El Nino into last year. Survival was very high in the sector, was higher in the sector. For us personally, within our company, we were above 90% survival on an annualised basis up to 2022. And unfortunately, as a result of what happened in that year with milder winters that we heard and elevated seawater temperatures, we then saw an influx of naturally occurring micro jellyfish, which are just a few millimetres in size, passing through the west coast of Scotland, all the way through to Shetland and also through to Norway. These have a direct physical impact onto the gills, but also can create on both farmed fish and also wild fish, and create a chronic gill health challenges. That meant that when we were then having to do our treatments for amoebic gill disease, which occur in the autumn, as was spoken about by Ben earlier, fish had inflamed gills, so we had acute mortality and we had chronic challenge. That led to a reduction in performance of those generations into 2023. Hence why our mortality dropped from the above 90% per year down to 83% in 2022, then down to 82% in 2023. But as we've spoken about earlier, the climate has changed, but we've also invested in more, with just short of £1 billion in both CapEx and operational costs since 2018 on fish health and welfare investments. And this covers the breadth of all of our activities, from the technology we spoke about earlier, from to the changes in husbandry practices and the way we farm as well. We actually took a step back after 2018 and reviewed the biological histories of some of our farms, and to see how, you know, are they in the right place? Are they stocked in the right way in the right time of the year to help improve farm fish survival? So I just want the committee to be assured that, you know, the sector has done everything they possibly can and will continue to help improve the health and welfare of our farm fish.
Climate changes, you are changing production methods and perhaps the amount of stock you have within pens.
All land farming, yeah.
Can I bring in Kimberly and Constant briefly on the same topic.
Yeah, sure. Just to add to what Ralph was saying there about micro jellyfish, this was a very novel challenge that came about across the sector over the last 2 years. But we haven't sat on our hands. You know, we've used this time to characterise the issue and to try and identify solutions to improve the health and welfare of our animals. So looking at things like aeration systems, barrier systems to keep these micro jellyfish and harmful algal blooms out of our cages, and other systems like bubble curtains, which I'm sure Connie can talk to.
Yeah, so on the farm base level, you know, climate change and environmental changes have caused this influx of plankton or microjellies that we're still learning and discovering about. And we've started sort of on the cold front, and we're training our staff, and our staff are the ones that are there every single day. They're the ones on the farm, and they're the ones assessing the environment. So we've trained staff in every company have trained their staff to go out every day, and what they do is they sample the water in which these fish are in. So they're taking jellyfish samples and they're taking plankton samples, and they're analysing this underneath microscopes. It takes a bit of time, but we understand it's really important, and it allows us to get an understanding exactly what is going on in the environment that the fish are in at that point in time, so we can put in mitigating measures if we need to, whether it be through aeration, which is where we would upwell water from down in the deep where there might not be any plankton or jellyfish. We can push this up and out, creating a space where there is no longer a water sort of hazard. We could maybe reduce feeding completely or stop it just to encourage the fish, and they'll stay in an area where there might not be any sort of plankton or jellyfish. Or as we just touched on then, we're investing in trialling in bubble curtains. So what that basically is we've got a sort of a pipework frame around the entirety of a farm, and that's submerged. And what we've got is these perforated holes, and we push compressed air through, and this then pushes up tiny little bubbles, and this creates like a wall or a barrier around the farm. So as, say, a jellyfish bloom comes through, it's actually pushed away from the farm and passes through it, well, around it, rather than going through the farm and causing any damage to the fish. So we're trialling this. So there's a lot of investment in sort of how we monitor the environment in which we're in. And if we are clear in the morning, we'll do another check of the water in the afternoon. So we're constantly monitoring it. We're fully aware that the environment changes. And it is the farmers there that they're very skilled and they're very knowledgeable. I think if you go to a farm and ask them about plankton, you'd be surprised how much information they could give you on it. And we're checking it all the time and monitoring it all the time. We've also got some AI research going on as to how we can get identification of plankton quicker, and the computer could do it for us. But we're just working through it. It's the investment, isn't it? We're looking at this innovation to push forward and make sure that we're farming to the best of our abilities in the environment in which we're in.
Just before we move on from the topic, which was to be focused on the media reports, in the letter to the committee from the Fish Health Inspectorate, it told us that the site was currently stocked with salmon of the average weight of 2.6 kilos. And on the day that the video footage was taken, they're suggesting that there was 1,082 kilos of biomass removed from the whole site. And from what you've said, 250 fish, so we can work it out, about 650 kilos were taken from that one pen. There is a suggestion that the video footage showed more than 250 fish in the nets. Now, I'm not an expert. I'm not very good at guessing how many fish there is in a net, but I just want absolute clarity. That one pen that we focused on, you're suggesting there was about 650 kilos of fish, or 250 individual fish that were taken out of that pen on the morning, which would suggest that there was another 750 kilos taken out from other pens. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Okay, thanks very much. And we're now going to move on to our next theme, a question from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. It's been a very interesting morning already. And I'm moving on to the theme, which is around the key REC committee recommendations. In 2018, the REC inquiry recommended that urgent and meaningful action needs to be taken to address regulatory deficiencies as well as fish health and environmental issues before the industry can expand. And what I understand is that since 2018, more than 50,000 tonnes, more biomass has received planning permission, but the Fish Health Inspectorate and SEPA data shows that in 2022 and 2023, four times more fish died in salmon farms than in 2018. The Fish Health Inspectorate numbers is in 2018, there were 3,782,475 seawater and freshwater deaths. In 2023, there were 17.4 million seawater and freshwater deaths. That's what we heard from SPICE briefings. And these numbers are a huge underestimate, as they don't include any fish that died in the first 6 weeks at sea or any deaths under the FIH's weekly reporting threshold, which, as I've been discussing, 1% of the total in a sea farm per week. So I'd be interested to hear from you if you can explain why you think, given the recommendation was that regulatory deficiencies as well as fish health and environmental issues need to be addressed before the industry could expand, why you think that the industry should be allowed to expand. So why are we seeing an industry expand when the recommendation was that things need to be taken care of that clearly haven't been taken care of?
Well, first of all, I don't agree at all that things haven't been taken care of. I absolutely refute that utterly. Secondly, we published to your committee, convener, a fish health plan which for the sector, which explained and showed the £1 billion of investment our companies have made. They're all represented here and they can talk to it, that we've made in exactly the to achieve the change. The sector today is very different from the sector that existed in 2018 that Mr. Mountain's committee had a look at that time, and I'm sure he would recognise that as well. And we're very proud of that change that's been achieved. And also, I think it's important to reflect that there have been, I think Ms. Burgess was asking about regulation, although I didn't quite understand what she was going on about, but I think she was asking about regulation. As you well know, convener, and you've had evidence on this, the government commissioned some independent assessment of regulation. We support that assessment. It shows the need for not less regulation, but for better and improved regulation. That's an agenda we entirely support in terms of the regulators in Scotland. We work with them on that. But I'm sure Ben could add some detail to the context.
I think the question's fair, but if you actually look at the level of expansion in the Scottish sector, it's been very, very low, almost flatlined. So the issuing of new licences or consent by SEPA is not proportionate to the number of fish stocked or the number of tonnage produced within the Scottish sector. So broadly speaking, I think the industry has been producing around about 180,000 tonnes, and that's pretty much been a flat line. No fish farmer wants growth that is not good growth in terms of achieving better welfare, lower mortality, higher average weight. You know, first and foremost, we're farmers. We care about the welfare of fish. We care about the livestock under our care. But we're also businessmen and women, and the way you make money in salmon aquaculture is about growing great quality salmon and selling them for the highest price you can achieve. I think it's important to know that this industry is evolving and innovating very, very quickly. So a lot of the applications that are being made is on the basis of closing down existing facilities, farms which are more inside the sea lock or less able to provide the good oxygen and the good water quality conditions that we need. So there is a process of closing down less suitable farms and trying to secure more open sea areas. And then that's what most of the consent that's being issued is aimed at, in my view.
Okay, thanks very much for that. So it's great to hear that you are doing things, the industry is doing things to tackle the issues. And as we've heard, spending almost £1 billion to tackle some of these issues, including investing in the sea lice treatment vessels, pesticides, cleaner fish. But clearly the mortality rate between 2018 and 23 shows that it's not really working. I hear the issue, I can't remember whether it was Ralph or Ben raised about the different changing conditions in terms of the warmer seawater, the El Nino, La Nina issues. But those aren't going to go away. They're going to keep coming back. The warming waters is something that fluctuates, is something that we are having to recognise and face in many sectors across Scotland. And it's also interesting to hear from Constance the issues, the bubble curtains, this kind of innovation technology. But to me, those sound like... but I think the root of what's underneath my question, because, Ben, you were talking about the rate of applications, but the industry has declared that it wants to double production by 2030. And how can that be possible if the current rates of mortality that we're looking at, they would have to be halved in order for that overall number of dead fish to be even stay at the 16 to 17 million number of dead per year. So there's this idea to increase and expand by 2030, but we are facing these extreme mortality issues and a fluctuating climate. So I just want to hear what more can we do, because it seems like the measures aren't really helping.
I would say I appreciate the concern. I don't think, as a Green MSP, we should entertain the idea that we don't rise to those challenges and produce the healthiest possible food we can in Scotland. That not doing that would be akin to a journey of importing energy, which we just shouldn't do. So we have to manage our way through those challenges, and I hope that you agree with that. This narrative that you can't map your way through the changes and innovate is, again, false. We are doing that. We are winning against these higher temperatures, which, you know, in June this year, or you compare June this year with June last year, the temperature on the West Coast was 3 degrees higher. That's an enormous difference, and it creates a real challenge for fish health in terms of gill disease and jellyfish. So, as we said, we are broadly staying the same size, roughly speaking, the same number of smolts going to sea every year, and we're investing enormously to make our way through these challenges. This narrative that the industry wants to double in size, that again, is completely false. The industry said it wanted to double the value and then economic contribution to Scotland, which I think, again, we should all get behind. But we are not in a position where we've got a cavalier approach to growth in the face of these challenges. Quite the opposite, in fact. We are holding broadly stationary in terms of production, and we are making headway in going through these difficult challenges.
Just to add to Ben there, that we're also investing for the future. So specifically on the topics like climate change and fish health and welfare, since the 2018 previous committee, we've invested in R&D collaboration with leading academics in Scotland and further afield on fish health and welfare, with more than £31.7 million of direct investment from the sector through SAKE-funded projects worth a total of £53.1 million. But we're not alone on this. The last few years have also seen significant challenges in other farming sectors, whether it be poor crop yields due to the drought conditions we saw in 2020, where hay had to be exported across the UK, through to flooding in some areas where complete yields were completely gone, to the increased northerly distribution of bird flu affecting the poultry sector and indeed wild bird populations around Scotland. So climate change is acknowledged as being associated with altering the spread of disease and pests in many countries, but through the investments that we've been making since 2018, as I say, across all of our operations, trying to improve the health and welfare of our stock, we believe that that we're in a best place for that. But we'll continue to invest, and we'll continue to try to improve the fish health and welfare.
And there's one simple other point on that, could you, if I may, which to Ms Burgess's question, which is that on mortality, we've explained, I think, at some length this morning what's happened in the last couple of years, and colleagues have talked exactly to all the innovations and technologies that have been introduced, and that's all new investment by our companies, but also investment into supply chain businesses, the length and breadth of Scotland. So that's investment into the Scottish economy. We spend £600 million a year across our companies into the Scottish economy in terms of those supply chain businesses. And our survival figures that were released on Monday for August are the best they've been for 5 years. So we totally appreciate that Ms Burgess has and members has concerns, but actually it is moving in the right direction, and we're really proud of that. That's why we're putting all that investment in.
Thank you. Liam MacArthur.
Thanks very much. I think Tavish has almost picked up the question I was going to ask. In the sense, the conversations I've had with the sector over a number of years, repeatedly the message is we are doing as much as we can for the reasons Ben set out in terms of enlightened self-interest, if for no other reason. And therefore the question about where's the drive for the innovation? Where does that come from? Is it sector-wide? Is it individual companies trying to get a steal a march on their competitors? And how does that sit in terms of international comparisons? Because I think routinely what is suggested is the Norwegian industry operates at a higher level, does things differently from the Scottish sector. And I appreciate the environment, the circumstances in which operators here are operating may be different to the Norwegian sector. But it would be helpful to understand, as I say, what's the drive for the research and the innovation that you've talked about, Tavish, that gives some confidence that in a changing environment we will continue to see significant investment to improve, rather than a message that we're doing as well as we can, look how well we're doing, which I think can come across to some as smacking of complacency. And therefore, I think a description of how that research and that innovation works and what the international comparators are would be helpful.
Well, shall I, maybe it would be appropriate to get Ralph to speak to Scottish Sea Farms and David to speak to Cook, because they both operate in your constituency and they can speak directly to these points. That's
just to pick an example of some of the research projects that have been taking place since 2018 in response to the environmental challenges that we have been facing, and that was a project which was funded by a Scottish Sustainable Aquaculture Innovation Centre, SAKE. With SRUC, which was based in SRUC, and involved most of the producers throughout the whole of Scotland, specifically targeted towards understanding the causes and risk factors of gill health challenges. So this wasn't, this is a specific thing and it was carried out over more than 3 years, I believe. We entered it towards the end of the project, and this was a landmark project where we looked at where samples were taken on individual farms across a time series over that period of time, and where we were using collaborating with academia from SRUC to develop models for us to understand, to actually really practically understand how many fish are significantly statistically significantly required for doing gill health samplings, and it was actually 5 per pen. So in things like this. And there's real practical things that come out of these projects. But the key driver is to improve fish survival, and that comes from improving fish welfare. One other project that we had, I know there's in the sector, is a long-term project with the University of Aberdeen of understanding, and with also Marine Scotland Science, of understanding what is the host response to gill health challenges. So gill health is our main cause of mortality in the sector. That should be understood completely. So we as a sector, we've targeted our research investments into our key challenges. Likewise to sea lice as well, there's been a huge amount spent on that because of the challenges we've faced on that. But that is under control. It's actually gill health is our main issue.
Thank you.
Yeah. I mean, in terms of do we seek to look further in Scotland? Of course we do. I mean, we're a worldwide industry, and we'd look to gain knowledge out of any country or anybody who made an advancement in anything they're doing. I mean, we're also farming fish in Tasmania, which is a very different temperature profile to Scotland, much, much warmer than what we're doing here, actually, and they're successfully farming fish out there as well. I mean, there's a lot of research done in Norway, Canada. I mean, we looked at all of those areas to gain knowledge, and they would look to seek knowledge from us as well. So if the question is, are we very inward-looking and not looking for solutions elsewhere, I think you'd find that the industry is out there looking for solutions.
No, and I recognise the makeup of the industry is such where you would expect that to take place. I suppose I'm curious, are there techniques, approaches, technology that's been deployed, for example, in Norway that's not deployed here, and if so, is there a rationale for it? Is it just the circumstances mean that it would not necessarily work in the same way, or?
I think there is no doubt that if there's a technology out there that is working well in another place, we'd look to implement it in Scotland where possible.
An example of sort of, I guess, global connectivity in terms of investment and innovation would be this bubble curtain. It's heavily used in Chile, and colleagues have been to Chile and spoken to colleagues there as to how this innovation would work. They have a lot of struggles with plankton, and we identify that this is going to be a continuing issue. So we're looking to other global aquaculture industry to see how we can improve what we're doing. During my time previously with Maui, we had internal working groups where we worked with colleagues in Norway and Canada to look at things like micro jellyfish or fish escape protocols and things like that. So there is a lot of discussion between different global bodies. I also was part of an industry-wide working group to deal with micro jellyfish and water quality within Scotland. So there is a lot of communication, because the reality is there's no benefit in having sort of an upper edge on the industry in terms of fish welfare and mortality. You know, we're all united together in the idea that we want to promote the best fish welfare, and together, we're a lot stronger in improving that, because we can develop ideas, share ideas, and trial things. We're much stronger together in terms of benefiting the welfare of the fish.
Okay. To try and answer your question about whether Norway does things better or whether they've got a higher standard than Scotland, and it's a wee bit tricky for me because I work for a sort of Norwegian or global salmon farming company. But I've lived in Norway and I spend a lot of time there on the farms. The production in Norway is what you would say is more intensive than in Scotland. So the stocking density is higher. The farms are at least twice as big, often three times the size of what you have. And the innovation is high throughout the sector. And there's a competition between companies, but then there's also a sector that is really struggling with the challenges of the environment, and it has to innovate very, very quickly to get ahead. And you've heard all the things that we're doing. So, you know, the regulation in Scotland is slower than in Norway, and the environmental standards are a lot tighter. So you can use less medicine to control parasites in Scotland than you can in Norway, and it's a harder environment to farm salmon in general. I think the biggest innovation that both Scotland and Norway is doing is the development of post-smolts, and that's industry speak. What it means is instead of putting 100 gram fish to sea, you put a 5 to 800 gram fish to sea, and then it's able to grow with just one summer at sea. So it misses out the second summer, which is when a lot of the mortality and challenges can come from the environment. And that's a way of increasing the level of fallowing, reducing the mortality, increasing production. And most companies are going down that route, or planning to go down that route. But it requires massive investment in often land-based facilities or other ways of holding those fish until you want to release them at 5 to 800 grams into the sea.
OK, thank you. We're going to suspend the meeting for approximately 5 minutes, so we'll come back at approximately 10:40.
Okay, well, we'll now continue with our investigation into salmon farming. We've got questions from Rhoda Grant on economic and social benefit. Rhoda.
Thank you. The REG Committee report looked at the issues which are common for many of the industries in rural Scotland about the lack of digital infrastructure, about the lack of housing for employment of staff within the industry. And recommendation 6 asked for the Scottish Government to work with enterprise agencies and local authorities and to look at how that could be addressed. And I wonder what progress has been made in looking at this recommendation. What's your own experience of digital infrastructure and housing for staff?
It's a very good point, Ms Grant. I mean, as you'll know, as a Highlands and Islands member, how significant the housing challenge is in the Highlands and Islands. And I think in broad terms, our companies, both supply chain and production, face the same challenges as we all do in terms of the availability of housing. And our companies, our colleagues here today can talk to what they have done in a practical sense about that. Digital infrastructure as well in terms of how we talked earlier on in the earlier session, for example, about how we monitor fish on farms using very high technology cameras. All that needs technical and clever digital infrastructure as well. So why don't we try and explain what we're doing to recognise the government's challenge and to play our part in trying to provide housing as well. The only other observation I'd make about that is that we'd be interested, as Ronan O'Hara gave you evidence last week, in terms of the Crown Estate fees that we pay to, frankly, you as Parliament and as government. We would be very keen that more of that, more of the fees we pay to, as it were, the government through the Crown Estate, are put back into local communities. And there's lots of ways that could be done, which would be helpful, including some of the ones you've just mentioned. But Kimberly, Bakkafrost, in the context of Applecross, it might be quite good to give Rhoda Grant a perspective on what you've done about housing there, because you had a particular shortage of housing.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, housing is a big issue up in some of our more rural areas, and as a sort of primary means of getting over that, we have purchased properties, we rent out certain areas to try and encourage people into the area to get the staff that we need. Where that isn't possible, we have to try and be a bit clever about how we hire people, so look at different working strategies, 2 weeks on, 2 weeks off, for example, so that people can return back to a home base and just work in the area for a period of time. So there's a few things that we can try, but it is a continual issue, and it's something that I think does need to be addressed so that we can get the skilled people that we need up in these highly invested in areas. I mean, Applecross is a multi-million pound investment to ensure that we can get the best possible, robust, large, small out to sea. And currently we are struggling to get people into the area because there just isn't the infrastructure there to be able to support them.
I can also make comment on the housing. So in Allapool, it's fairly remote and rural, as you know, and we sort of struggled historically to keep staff because of housing, and we've invested in purchasing property or pods, a variety of different types of housing to allow us to retain and keep the skilled farm staff that we've talked about previously and enable them to stay locally and live locally within Allapool.
Ben, do you want to mention other examples?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I mean, we've actually just started to make it a regular part of an annual budget. That's several hundred thousands of pounds per year to build houses and infrastructure in the islands and west coast where we work. So we got to the stage where you could no longer wait for local authorities or government action to develop houses where we needed them. That said, on Colonsay, the company I work for put up around £1.6 million towards 12 affordable homes, but it was matched by the Scottish Government. So that gave over £2.5 million, I guess, to create 12 houses, some of them affordable houses, some of them for staff working on the fish farms in Colonsay. We've done similar projects on Mock Rum up on the West Coast, and I know that other companies are doing this regularly. So we're making quite a strong contribution to housing, but just through direct action of building houses.
I suppose, let me be fair, I mean, when Emma Roddick was a minister, she did the right thing by having a policy based on tackling rural depopulation. We entirely agree with that. We'll play every role we can in that, and we hope the government, whatever government, will do more in that area. And I think we're describing what the private sector can do. We're happy to partner with government and parliament on these kind of initiatives.
Yeah, I think David would.
We're all doing things on housing, and I think slightly different tack. I mean, we're looking at types of housing for equally just for our workers, but I think it's a very important thing that what we'd like to do is for people to feel that they could come and live in these communities and they could take their families as well and further enhance what's going on in the community so they can become a part of the community and their children may go to school. And I think that's what needs to be encouraged as well. So.
Yeah, just a supplementary on Ben's response. I understand why companies are, and indeed it's welcome that companies are investing in housing and infrastructure. I suppose my one concern is in rural areas in the past we've had issues with tied housing. I would worry if the only solution we had to housing was tied housing because, you know, as David said, we want to bring people into the community, we want them to live there. We want local people to be able to stay, but if the housing is tied to the job, they can't then move around as they would naturally within a community.
Yeah, I think that's a very valid point, and we're conscious of that. So we don't tie the housing all the time. If you're building houses for employees, you cannot just give them all away. But what we try to do is make them available to buy. For and help people financially to buy the houses, because you can always build more. And at least companies our size are capitalised to the extent where that's fairly easy and doable. A lot of the projects have an affordable home element where it's houses for salmon farm workers and houses for community members. And then we've even built service plots and then handed those over to communities so that they in time can build the houses. So I think it's a very important point you made, but we're focused on making sure that the houses are not tied.
Thank you. Can I ask another question? Kimberly, this is pretty much for yourself. It's regarding the Baker Frost processing site in Stornoway. So we're obviously concerned that that's closed. Would you be able to give us the reasons of why that closed and what are the issues that caused it to close, and would that have, are those issues likely to arise further within processing? Can we expect more closures?
I think some of the issues that we've already discussed this morning about survivability and the challenges we've faced over the last few years have resulted in the majority of our fish production being harvested out over the next 18 months. So that means that unfortunately, the North processing facility was going to be closed for a period of time. Overall, our strategy is to create shared value, and we give significantly to the community fund. So it is an unfortunate situation that we have been left in, but this is a result of some of the more challenging circumstances that we've faced, and also some of the inflexibility within the consenting regime to be able to move sites and close sites that are no longer acceptable into more acceptable areas where we could perhaps remedy health situations and make the overall survivability better.
So that last point, Commissioner, that's helpful to Rhoda Grant. The chief executive of Baker Frost, so ultimately Kimberley's big boss, up in the Faroe Islands, met the cabinet secretary your cabinet secretary quite recently on exactly that. And the point that the company is making is aligns to your agenda, which is the reform of the consenting process would help Baker Frost be much more efficient in terms of their operations in the Western Isles, in terms of their sea sites, and that's something that this Baker Frost need, but indeed all our companies need. So it's very much a shared agenda. But I know that the Chief Executive of Baker Frost has put that absolutely to the Cabinet Secretary, looking for support for that proposal. And it does, in fairness, come out of the independent report into regulatory reform. We're really supportive of that, and we hope that we'll see further progress in that. And that would help, as Kimberly rightly says, progress in the Western Isles too.
Okay, just to, one further question. Do you expect the processing site to reopen? And if you do, how, given that I visited there actually and saw the skills of the workforce there, given that workforce will have moved on, hopefully found other jobs, I mean, how do you protect something with that level of skill and rebuild it after closure?
This area is somewhat out of my remit, but certainly, you know, we try to assist the workers in relocating to other jobs within the business where that was appropriate. But unfortunately, sorry, I can't really comment on that. I don't really know the ins and outs of it.
But again, just to be helpful to Rhoda Grant, and forgive me, Kimberly, the Scottish, so the management of the Scottish operation were meeting the Western Isles Council yesterday in Stornoway on exactly these issues. So please be assured there are very active discussions between the company and, in this case, both the enterprise, so High, and the local authority on these important matters.
Yeah. We could maybe write, I'm sorry for putting you on the spot, but given that you were here, it was worth asking the question.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. As well as housing, there's community benefit that occurs. And when the Rural Committee did their inquiry, they were talking about how the industry can provide benefits to local communities. And in the Griggs Review, there was also information about how communities can be better supported. So I'd be interested, like when we did the community engagement at Oban, some people in the room thought that the jobs was piecemeal, but Tavish said that, you know, jobs is £36,000 is the average earnings, and there's a lot of jobs. So I'd be interested in what could you give us as far as information about how the communities could be supported in different ways?
Ben? Yeah, you know, sometimes when you sort of get oversensitive to this, what's fairly niche activism, you know, the best cure for it is to go out around the farms and go and visit the local communities. So if I go out on Colonsay, they think the salmon farm development is largely fantastic. It's created jobs, it's created a vibrance on the island. The average pay is £36,500. You can build a career for life, and the company will help you in a variety of ways, or all the companies were. Just to link your question with the previous question, I think the real value of the salmon sector is you can only do it in certain places. And what companies try and do is build on the value chain. So obviously we're concerned about the closure in Stornoway of a plant. But rest assured, what the company is trying to do is build the value chain within Scotland. So my company is invested into fish feed, created a lot of jobs there. It's invested into value adding, created over 1,000 jobs in Rosyth. And so if you go back to 2010, Maui had 456 people in the company. We've now got over 1,800 people. But you still go to a community event and hear activists say, well, there's less people that play in the rugby team that work in fish farms, the jobs aren't there. And again, that's really false. Like, what companies are trying to do is build the value chain in Scotland on throughout all of it, from breeding salmon eggs to producing fish feed to doing value adding. And over time, that will create a lot more well-paid jobs in the sector.
And in addition to that, Ms. Harper, and it's a great question, that the supply chain that work to Ben and Ralph and Connie and the rest of my colleagues are providing jobs in other areas. So, for example, DFDS and O'Toole's, who haul most of the fish and indeed the seafood out of Scotland, employ, for example, 150 people in Lark Hall, central belt of Scotland. So, and seafood is core to their business. So there are other kind of knock-on effects of our export business or our transportation system, which mean jobs in different places. But David, do you want to just talk to community benefit?
Yes, I think it's very important to realise that an awful lot of these jobs occur in very, very remote places, very peripheral areas, and it's where I come from. I mean, I come from the very north of Shetland, where we farm fish, and down the west coast of Scotland, down in Orkney. But these jobs are in very, very, as I say, peripheral areas. We're providing employment for a huge number of people. There's jobs for school leavers, we do apprenticeships, we look to skill up our people, there's jobs for graduates, the range of jobs that we have, there's farmers, engineers, fish health specialists, environmental people, IT, sales. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. I mean, just to give an example of what we do in Shetland, we farm fish in Yellons and Fetler, which are the North Isles of Shetland, which are the outer isles of the outer isles, basically. And there, we employ, of the working population, over 100 people in that community. The population of that community is in and around 1,500 people. So the working population of that community is much less than that. So as a percentage, we are employing a massive percentage of the people. We're not the only job up there, but we're certainly one of the main employers. Similar scenario in Westray, in Orkney, where we employ 35 people, 30 of which are resident in Westray, population of about 600 people, with a working population much less. We find there's ageing populations in these areas. We need economic activity in these areas. It's not just the jobs that we directly do as well. It's the supplier jobs, as Tavish speaks about. If I take a drive through Lerwick and look at the engineering firms that are there, and I look at the names on the doorstep, we are providing money into all those things. We're providing money into local shops, into just every part of the community. And I think it's very important it goes beyond that. It goes beyond what do our people give back to their communities that they are living in as well. And you'd look to emergency services where things are done by volunteers. I could point to the Coast Guard, where we have Dennis Johnson up in Unst, who's just retired after 30 years' experience in the Coast Guard. Throughout that time, he's been available at all times through his working life to jump to any emergency and dials. I could point to Kevin Sinclair or Fraser Paul in Yellnons, as retained firefighters, same scenario. We have ambulance drivers who work as a part of our team. And as well, and I think it's not just emergency services, it goes on to local halls where committees have to be put in place. Volunteers, I have Michelle Johnson, who works for us in the Mediel Hall, puts in a huge amount of her own time. And that hall provides facilities for the community to be able to use, and that goes for the whole community. In terms of I think it's important to look at schools as well. In the areas where we operate, in Unst, for example, we recently looked at who was in the school, and 20% of the school population was directly related to the people that we are employed by. It's exactly the same in Westray and Unst. We look to do partnerships with those schools. Get in. After this, I think in the next few weeks, I'm going to do mock interviews with pupils in S4 in some of the local schools. Probably one of them might be my son, which might be a bit embarrassing for him, but that's okay. But we look to work with developing youth workforce, looking to get more people into employment, and that's what the people do. But the companies, as well as that, we all have community benefit funds. We put hundreds of thousands of pounds into communities every year. I mean, Cook does it themselves. Scottish Sea Farms, I know they do some excellent work. Their Hearted Community Fund, Maui do it. Back of Frost do it. And I mean, you could look at something. It's a shame Liam has left, because I was going to just mention the Island Games, which is going to be in Orkney in 2025. I know that Back of Frost, I think, are the main sponsor for the Western Isles team. I think that when Cook have certainly sponsored the Orkney and Shetland teams, although I hope that Shetland will do better than they do in terms of medal haul, but that's by the by. But I think basically everything I speak about is basically that I'm very proud to work in this industry. I feel we put a lot back into communities we are, and I really feel that the industry is part of the fabric of the communities that we do operate in. And,
Just have a wee final sup. It just reminds me that we visited Dumfries and Galloway, so it actually has a hatchery as well. So it isn't just Western Isles that are, I suppose, benefiting in terms of employment. So that was an interesting visit that I had.
Well, thank you for mentioning that, Ms Harper, because that's right. Aquagen is a significant player in the Scottish market and an important part of the wider salmon family, and employs people in the south of Scotland, absolutely. I don't think there's a constituency or a region of this country that doesn't have some part of our supply chain in it, and that means very much the Central Belt, as well as the areas that, for example, Dave has just been describing. So a very fair point.
Supplementary from Christine Graham.
But do we have figures for the local economic advantage in figures for, if I separate them out, Shetland and Orkney, and declare an interest to get a sister who lives in Orkney? So do we have figures for that, and do we have figures for the contribution that is made to the various organisations, the charitable stuff? It would be interesting to know the economic impact on these local areas that really do need employment activity.
We do have those figures, Ms Graham, and we'll make sure they're in your inbox within the hour.
Well, I think it's for the committee, not just for myself.
Well, but I know you want the Orkney ones, so we'll make sure you have those ones. And the committee indeed can have very much the breakdown we do
useful
across the whole part of the whole of Scotland. Yeah.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. So I believe that Salmon Scotland has a community engagement charter, and it says, we believe that salmon farming companies should take a good neighbour approach with local communities by operating with transparency and integrity and adopting best practice methods of engagement. And where relevant, we will engage communities in a vote to allow the local people to have a direct say in what's happening and consider, and it goes on to say, consider putting the decision to a community vote. It's the ultimate test of whether the case has been made for a site and has the support of the wider population. Have you ever had a situation where you've actually used that charter and actually gone to that point of putting things to a vote with community?
Ben, do you want to?
Yeah, I mean, I favour that method. I think that salmon farming businesses should be absolutely transparent on the wealth that they create at a national and local level. They should also be very transparent on the impact that they have in the environment and how that's mitigated. So I think in almost all the new developments that we have done, we have put it to a community vote, and we've had a positive outcome on Mock, on Rum, twice on Rum actually, Colonsay, and a number of other locations where the community has looked at all the information, including quite comprehensive environmental impact assessments and economic studies and what the arrangement is with the community in terms of developing housing and infrastructure, and then the community has decided to go ahead with it. There was one occasion where we proposed a site on the Isle of Canna, which in my opinion was a great location for a farm. The vote narrowly went against us. That was, I think, because most of the people that voted against it were employed by the NTS and encouraged to vote against it. The people who were not voted in favour, we didn't have a majority, so we didn't proceed at that time. We like to bring communities with us and be a positive multiplier for good effect within the community.
Okay, thanks for that. I'm interested, you mentioned those three islands. What about the new feed barge at Maui? I don't think that went to a vote, but I understand from talking to local people that there was high opposition to that, and at a meeting Maui said that they weren't obliged to inform the community about the expansion plans of that feed barge. And and since then, obviously, Maui has withdrawn the application. But I just wonder, is it kind of like a sense that I get from talking to communities that, you know, surely communities should have the right to know about full expansion plans for salmon farms that operate in their waters? At what point does the industry consider community objection to a particular planning action application to be legitimate? And using the feed barge application example, once a community has rejected an application, surely that should be the point where the industry, you know, accepts that, takes notice, and lets go of it. But what's happening is that there's a sense from communities that applications get rejected, but then the industry comes back, and we've got an example recently in Skye. So there's something about this community engagement charter and wanting to listen to communities and respect them and going to votes and things like that, but then also kind of doubling down. Is that because that's the right place for something to happen for the industry? I mean, one of the things that we heard at the community event was that the community can't move. They can't leave that place. And so, yeah.
If I may, Convener, sorry.
Okay. Katie, she was going to come in, but happy Ben.
I think we were in team play. I think I was going to answer part of it, and then Connie, who's actually in that area and held the meeting, is best place to add. So I suspect with respect that you take the feed from quite a narrow segment in the community, and I think that, you know, the broader segment where we work is in the majority supportive of aquaculture, but wants it done in the most sustainable, best possible way. In terms of the Corrie application in Ullapool, we We have not put any new barges in. We've worked with the company, given it a lot of autonomy. It has a fantastic brand in the US where it sells an artisan salmon with really high demand. And we're very keen to work with the community and keep it on site. So we held a public meeting and there was negativity towards a feed barge going in. So we then withdrew the application. We had a couple of meetings where we completely listened to the community, and then we are going to reconvene and propose a route towards automating the feeding which meets their requirements. So, Connie, you promised the community a certain route. What's the plan at Westeros?
So I think it's important to highlight we did engage with the community. We held three meetings over a short period of time, and the importance is that we listened to what they had to say and we withdrew the application. So we're taking on board the feedback that they gave and the concerns that they raised in the meetings, and we're finding a solution and believe we've found a solution that will promote best feeding practice that is good for the environment and good for the welfare of the fish, but also alleviate the concerns that the community have. And we're planning to set a community meeting again to come to them with the concept and the idea and discuss it with them prior to putting the application in. And that's the steps that we're taking shortly in the next sort of few weeks.
Listening to the community, pausing the application, removing the desire to put a feed barge in, and working with the community to put something in which manages to feed the fish well and keep the welfare good and isn't a feed barge. And I think that's very positive, you know.
I think the other observation, Convener, if I may, just to conclude that point, is that most of my colleagues here live in the Highlands and Islands. You know, I hope no one's suggesting that we don't know what's actually happening. And David just spoke very eloquently about living in Shetland and the reality of being a very active member of his community. So I do think, I'm sure Ariane Burgess would accept this, that we all care deeply about the places we live. We live in them. And I think that's quite an important part of how we make these assessments as well.
Just a brief follow-up. Ben, you mentioned that you've got a plan to feed the fish appropriately. Could you just describe what that plan is?
Yeah, I think the concerns that were raised at the time was what about the potential for microplastics to come from the feed pipe? Now, we're obviously concerned about that, but it is not the substantial part of the microplastic issue that we face. But we're working to change the plastic so it's very durable and doesn't produce any microscopic particles. We're looking to feed the feed in a water feeding system, which moves the feed in water rather than air. That uses lower power, it produces less noise, and we've used that on several occasions. The other option is to have this hybrid between hand feeding and mechanical feeding, where you have hoppers on every single pen, and there's some level of automation, but you've got a combination of people filling the hopper and hand feeding. And I think we'll go down that route. But basically where we want to be is a good neighbour, improve our business, work with communities and have a good dynamic and a friendly way of improving things between the businesses and the communities which are intertwined.
Thanks very much. One very brief supplement to David Brown. It's picking up on my colleague Rhoda Grant's a question about housing and infrastructure, and I'd be interested to know if Cook Aquaculture and the industry in general would be interested in supporting the fixed links that are being called for from Yale and Unst as an important part of infrastructure, which I know the salmon farming industry relies on.
We rely heavily on inter-island ferries in Shetland. All our fish are processed on the island of Yale. So not only do our fish have to catch the ferry south from Lerwick to Aberdeen every night, they also have to catch several inter-island ferries through Shetland itself. And I think the inclusion of tunnels into Shetland would be fantastic. I think it really helped to reinvigorate the communities. I think that I think you'd find that people would move back into the islands if that was the case. People don't necessarily want to have to get a ferry to get to their work. It adds a huge amount to their working day, basically. And I think if such things were put in place, I think those islands would certainly benefit from it.
Just to clarify, my question is...
Ariane, we're very tight for time. I think we've moved significantly away from the purpose of this meeting and asking people about questions which don't relate to the recommendations from the previous committee. I think we could be here for an awful long time if we all took that liberty. I think it's appropriate at this stage to let members know that as a result of the additional hour we took... looking and quite rightly spending on the media reports relating to the salmon industry. We're running about an hour late. I've been minded to push on, but I just want to check with the witnesses whether how that's going to work out with their plans for today.
You should have been away by 12, convener.
Okay. What I'm going to do, I'm going to briefly suspend the meeting to have a discussion around this and we'll decide the way forward. I'll suspend the meeting. Thank you. We're going to continue the session and we're going to move on to theme four, which is environmental impacts and questions from Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Mayor. A key development since the REC committee report was the introduction of SEPA's new Finfish Aquaculture Regulatory Framework, which came in the 1st of June 2019. And that, of course, brought in a new and tighter standard for organic waste deposited by fish farms. What key actions has the industry made in addressing the environmental issues related to waste and chemical discharges identified by the REC inquiry?
I think you ask a very good question and you make exactly the right point about the introduction of that 2019 scheme, and my colleagues can talk to the specifics of what companies have individually done, but we agreed with the introduction of the new regulatory framework. It requires much more sophisticated modelling of our farms prior to consenting using updated modelling software, and it allows much more extensive marine monitoring of the seabed once the farm is consented. So it plays exactly to your point. Do we know what's happening on the seabed? Yes, actually do, and this model helps us do that. So it's a step forward. It absolutely makes the point we're making that things have changed dramatically since 2018 in the earlier report. And to support the more rapid assessment of the seabed, we have supported several projects to develop projects to assess benthic biodiversity, and we work with CEPA and national and international academic partners to deliver those projects. So I hope that gives you the assurance that we absolutely take that head on. It's really important for us. It's actually an advantage to us in terms of our fish farms for that. And I'm sure Ralph could speak further to the practicalities of it if that was helpful.
Maybe then.
Or indeed anyone else.
I'm happy for either of you.
Okay, so obviously salmon farmers require really high water quality, and so you have to have a very relatively minimal level of organic enrichment underneath the farm. The CEPA new regulations tighten that. You've also seen a significant reduction in bath treatment medicines and in-feed medicines, so they're markedly down in use. Compliance with CEPA on seabed criteria is increased, and it increased actually after the industry temporarily held more fish during COVID. So generally, this is a very good picture with high level of compliance and really demonstrable sustainability criteria.
What evidence have we got for the assertion that there's been a reduction in the amount of chemicals and waste as a result of this? Do we have any evidence? And if so, who's collecting it?
Maybe I can comment on that. CEPA collects that information from all of the producers. And it's important to actually point out that every single consent of every farm is assessed by CEPA through modelling as well, to determine the acceptable biomass that could be permitted on the farm that would cause no significant harm. No significant harm. So that is therefore then assessed by CEPA and through the samples that are taken on farm to provide the evidence for that. And so far there's been very, very high compliance. Unfortunately, as was referenced by the CEPA witness information from CEPA, that they had a cyber attack back in 2019, and we still yet to have a system where that information is published. So it seems to be prioritised for other activities in CEPA.
But all this is published by the companies individually and then published in by Salmon Scotland.
So in that sense, Mr. Bitty, we would welcome CEPA publishing it, and we would look to them to publish it because they did have a system in place before. As Ralph rightly says, cyber attack has stopped that. We absolutely endorse that approach, which involves that publication.
At the moment, the information comes from the companies themselves.
But CEPA do them. It's CEPA collect it.
They collect it, but they don't publish it. Therefore, the only publicly available information is from the companies.
Yeah, but all the companies have, most of the companies have institutional investors, pension funds, and this has to be absolutely transparent. So if you look at, it's published as part of the sustainability report of a company. There are other bodies like the Aquaculture Stewardship Council, which audit it, and the Coral Fair Index, which rank both the reporting and transparency. So I think you'd be very confident that it's accurate. It's warts and all, and the situation has improved a lot.
You'd find that under the new framework, the monitoring requirements of the farms have changed as well compared to what it used to be. It used to be that when we monitored a farm at peak biomass, it was done on a single transect in the direction of the tidal flow, which was seven stations that were reviewed on every site. That's basically a grab sample of the seabed is taken up and analysed to see what is living down there. Under the new framework, it's actually 28 samples that are taken on sites in four different transects. And this, the areas that are specifically designed around the modelling that's done on each site, so it's a much more predictive model and should accurately show that what impact the farm is having on the environment.
And yet there's been criticism of CEPA's capacity to actually do the analysis.
So I kind of feel a bit sorry for CEPA because they get it in the neck all the time as well from both sides. We support them in this work, as we've suggested today, because it's really important for us that they get this and they are able to publish, and we'll work with them to achieve that. That's really all we can add to that point. Sure, you had them in front of you, did you not, Mr. Beattie, back in June?
Yeah. I'm sure somebody will be picking that up. Turning to the Scottish Government's analysis of its consultation on new standards for the use of emamectin benzoate, It found that farmers generally prefer to use this this chemical as an in-feed medicine because it was easy to administer and didn't require fish to be special handling and all the rest of it. Now, industry expressed concern about the potential for tighter standards around its use because it would have a negative impact on fish welfare and mortality. Do you still have these concerns?
Yeah, I think we do have these concerns, but we have to accept them and move forward with the best healthcare we can in other ways, and that's why you've heard so much about fresh water and these FLS treatments that generally remove sea lice through filtration. What will happen with MMX in benzoate, its trade name is Slice, is that there was a lot of focus from a specific... they are stakeholders, and we respect the fact that they're stakeholders, but they're quite niche in terms of how they focus on claiming that there's been environmental impact. To my knowledge, nobody has showed that there was any environmental impact beneath the farms or in the near field area of the farms through emamectin use. But they lobbied extremely hard, and what SEPA did was revisit the standard for emamectin. Normally, when you set a level for a medicinal treatment or a pesticide, depending on what you want to call it, you have a 100-fold safety factor. So you find out what's the level that would affect the most vulnerable animal, in this case the sediment, because that's where it's going. You have a 100-fold safety factor. SEPA brought in place a 1,000-fold safety factor, and that drastically reduced the amount that could be used. And then they also chose to use a freshwater animal, which was much more vulnerable, so they tightened the amount that could be used significantly. We complained about that because we didn't think the science was sound. They put it back to an independent group called the Water Research Council that actually told SEPA that they got it wrong by a factor of 20 or 30. And this was a Scottish Government process. So then SEPA were instructed to take the level back up. But it was still a lot lower than what we previously had. And our concern here is we all want to protect the environment and we all want to do it through the strongest possible science. But when you have a very niche level or niche area of activists pressurising SEPA intensely to overreact, and you take away a vital medicine which is administered, you know, with great welfare for the fish, and then you beat down on the industry and say your mortality is too high, how do you win that? So we have essentially had to accept it. We're not happy about it, but we've complied in full, and then we've innovated to bring in other treatment methods. And you know, if you compare this to another livestock or farming situation, ivermectin, which is the same as avermectin, which is Slice, is available widely in all the forms of terrestrial farming. You don't even need a vet to prescribe it in most cases. You can buy it over the counter at a Harborough store. It's specifically focused, and it shows you how tightly aquaculture is regulated, but also how the regulators can really overreact when they're focused in with this kind of activism. And that can be difficult for us to deal with.
Now, clearly that's an ongoing issue. So how is it going to be resolved? I mean, is there ongoing dialogue on this between the interested parties? How is this going to play out?
Well, I think in truth the government's made their decision on that one, and I think it is now set, Mr. Beattie. I think you ask a very good question. We would be open, of course, to more dialogue for the reasons that Ben has illustrated to you this morning, but the current position is as determined, and we, as Ben says, comply with that.
I think just to follow up, I think the process has been wrong. Yeah, we've had to accept it, but if you have a medicine which is very effective in aquaculture, and there is a huge database which says there is little or no evidence of effect, and then someone over-eggs a potential effect and takes away their vital medicine. I mean, how would you feel if that was a cancer drug or a human medicine? You know, so we're a little bit angry about it, but in the same time, we just have to accept it, and we care for the mass welfare we have, so we innovate and find a different route.
Sorry. Talked about bringing in other medicines to act with this, medicine or chemical, whatever, is that creating another problem in itself?
No, we're not planning to bring in new medicines in aquaculture to replace this compound. It has been the use of fresh water and the other treatment methods that we've talked about.
Supplementary amendment, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. One serious concern that's been raised about the use of chemicals in salmon farming is the impact on lobster larvae. Deltamethrin has been shown in research that was conducted in Norway to be lethal to European lobster. It is used in Scotland. It's allowed to be used in Scotland for farms that have organic certification. Is there work going on to reduce the use of it? And is there concern in the industry about the impact on lobster?
No, so there's no concern in the industry on the use of it and the consequential impact on lobster larvae. All these medicinal compounds can have an impact on crustaceans because mm-hmm. they're designed to kill sea lice, which are crustaceans. So Scotland by far has the tightest regulatory framework where very limited amounts are allowed to be used. They're subject to a very large mixing area and the traces in the environment are well below a threshold that would cause impact. In other places like Norway, you can use 300% of the dose rate in slice. You can use the same in Canada. I'm going to Canada tomorrow, and I note that it's one of the Bay of Fundy is one of the largest harvesting areas of lobster. It's also full of fish farms. You know, and you speak to people at a local level, and they say that they can catch under the pens and. Part of the reason why the bay produces so many lobster is that there's all this structure in there. So you can twist science a bit here, but I don't think we've got any concern.
It's not really twisting science, though, to say that there's an impact. That impact and that relationship has been noted in research, scientific research, and we know that the half-life of the chemical is 140 days and that it can spread 39 kilometres. So there's really no concern.
So I don't think... Are you talking about the half-life of amectin or the half-life of deltamethrin?
Deltamethrin.
No, I don't actually think the half-life is that high. I think it binds very quickly to anything organic. So when you've treated it in a pen of fish, it's bound to the fish and the organic on the nets. So a lot less... than has been put in the pen is released, and then you have the mixing zone, which guarantees that the level of dilution is way below a threshold that could impact a non-target organism like a lobster larvae. So you ask me, am I confident in that? Yes, I'm confident, and to be fair to CEPA, they have a very, very stringent and rigorous way of working it out, and Scotland is allowed to use the least amount of medicine in all other geographies.
Just very briefly, we heard at the community engagement that the levels of ivermectin benzoate was now so low that you're allowed to use that it was effectively ineffective and was being used less and less by the industry. Is that correct?
Can I tell you? Yes, it is correct. And back to the previous question, that we are concerned actually on the impacts of this on health and welfare. So we typically would use slice or ivermectin benzoate in the early stage of the cycle, say up to 1 kilo of size, when you don't want to touch young fish because of the potential impact that could have, as we spoke about at length earlier. But separate to that, that we also it is critical for the treatment of another situation which occurs in midsummer, which is Calagus, which is a similar sea louse to the main sea louse for leps, but this is carried by migratory marine fish, by herring and by mackerel. And suddenly, like in the month of August, we typically see multiple farms in a whole farming area suddenly seeing significant numbers of Calagus arriving on them. And for us to be able to have access to a medicine, an in-feed medicine, that we can... through prescribing by veterinary advice and direction, be able to administer to multiple populations at once, which is highly effective. These lice are very, very naive, so they're very sensitive to the medicine. Gives it complete treatment without having to touch the fish. Without having that availability of slice, that will mean that we'll have to go in and handle these fish. We will have to do other ways of trying to remove the Calagus from these fish. And when you have multiple farms requiring that level of intervention, that is challenging. So yes, I think we are still very concerned about the impacts of these levels. Whilst we will do everything we possibly can to mitigate against it, it is a concern.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Convener. Salmon Scotland has a service complaint lodged to SEPA about the timeframes they're taking with licensing applications. They were expected sooner, obviously. Has this issue been resolved, or is it still ongoing?
I think it would be fair to say, Ms Grant, that the issue has been overtaken by the Griggs review into the consenting regime, which provides evidence as to the determination periods that all the different regulatory bodies take, and that period is longer than we'd all wish. I mean, I think you've had evidence not just from us, but from I saw Fisheries Management Scotland writing to you yesterday, making exactly the same point on the regulatory system. So I think there's a common view that the system could be more efficient and more effective, and we would like to see these time periods becoming much more efficient and much more aligned between the many different regulators we deal with. So I suppose the strong answer is that we're dealing with that in a slightly different way now, and that comes out of Russell Griggs' report from February of 2022.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Moving on to the next section, and I've got questions from Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. It's about the interaction between the sea lice regulatory reform and wild salmon interactions overall. But in a previous committee session, Wildfish expressed concern about the reliability of the sea lice count data. Can any of the witnesses comment on how often they carry out sea lice monitoring and how reliable that data is, but also comment on the assertion that there is a big gap in data in sea lice reporting?
So I don't think we'd recognise there's a big gap in data at all. And I think, could I be gently suggest, Ms Hamilton, that Wildfish have an agenda here? They are not in favour of our industry at all, indeed quite the reverse. They are an anti-salmon farming campaign organisation. And they're quite entitled to be so, and they're a stakeholder, but I think their evidence to you was certainly came from that perspective. We, all of our companies, deal with sea lice and monitor very regularly, and I think David and Connie could start by describing exactly what they do. Yeah.
So, I mean, weekly we're doing lice counts. So we're reporting this data. It gets reported every week. We're required to report this data, and we actively want to report this data. The farm guides are trained on site, whether it be by a fish health vet within the industry, within our company, or through online training and on-site training. So the staff are very well educated in the different types of stages of sea lice, and we are required to track this data. It's beneficial for us to do it weekly or more than once a week if we wanted to see the progression of sea lice. So it actually gives us a lot more information to be able to give informed decisions as to how we move forward in our farming practices.
Yes, sir. Sorry, just to continue on that, I mean, there may be occasional weeks where we don't get sea lice count done, but please forgive us if it's blowing a force 12 in Shetland and we don't want people to die by doing it and things like that. But these are real-life scenarios where we can't get counts done occasionally. And if a gap should appear for that reason, then really I don't apologise for that. But we do weekly lice counts as required as a requirement for Marine Scotland.
And Kimberly can add to that if that's helpful.
Yeah, just to be clear, we don't just count sea lice because it's a regulatory requirement. We do it for our own information. We collect this information, as Connie said, at minimum once a week from every single enclosure on the site, on every single farm. But where we have higher pressure or the potential that we might need to intervene, we might do that more frequently. I know on some of our farms, we've gone in and we've checked fish every single day just to see what the trend is doing and whether we need to get a vessel in there quickly and start to commence with an intervention. So it's for our own benefit. It's not just because there's a piece of legislation there that says we have to.
I just want to address Tavish Scott's point there, but Salmon Scotland also criticise the lack of data to make decisions, and without taking 20% of the data counts since 2021, then that then exacerbates the lack of data that's collected.
Yeah, I can help in this one because I'm a bit closer to it. So it's in salmon farmers' interest to absolutely know what's going on with sea lice. And I can see reports on a per pen basis in every farm that we operate, and we operate quite a lot in Scotland. So the idea that we, you know, we wouldn't accurately report this is, it's not funny because it's serious, but when you see, when you listen to them say that, you think, gosh, you used to say the same thing, that we didn't have transparency. And then we gave you transparency in spades, and now you say the data is not robust enough. But we've got millions and millions invested, and the data is crucial. So the integrity and the accuracy of the data is number one important to us. We have, you know, modelling programmes, algorithms that can predict sea lice, how it will occur, what stages, we can predict the effect of treatments. It's really complex stuff because, first of all, you're striving for the best animal welfare, and you've also got tens and tens of millions, in fact, hundreds of millions invested in it. So we have to get it right. I think the data reporting in the Scottish sector is very, very good, but there are some days where for weather or for if you during doing a treatment, you wouldn't count sea lice and you wouldn't record that.
Okay. Just to go back to the discussion, we've had a very long discussion on the situation with gill health, which seems to be, you know, a huge problem. Professor Martin in a previous session said that you know, the treatments that all the panellists have talked about would not be able to be used in those circumstances to treat sea lice, and therefore secondary infection would then become the reason for mortality. Do you think that we're now overly focused on the mortality on sea lice and should actually be looking at the issues that we have with gill health? And I mean, I don't want to add more suggestions that there should be more reporting, but how is gill health reported, and should that be sort of, is that something that's taking over the issues of sea lice?
Yes, I think, you know, obviously we spoke earlier about the gill health is by far our greatest challenge for fish health and welfare. It varies and it's seasonal, and we can control certain aspects of it, like amoebic gill disease, or keep it in control. Sea lice, you know, it is, in terms of our categories of causing mortality, is so low that it's within below the 1% threshold of, you know, it's not even on, it doesn't appear on the pie chart. Fish shouldn't die of sea lice, as was spoken about earlier. So when I think the witness spoke before, yes, so if you were to ever have a situation where you had a population of fish which had another health condition which meant that you weren't able to treat for a sea lice challenge on them, then they would be harvested out as quick as possible, so that they would be removed as a last resort. So it's not so certainly, you know, our reporting on sea lice is highly transparent, you know, and just to add as well to that conversation, our farmers were counting sea lice and recording sea lice way before there was any legislation, or way before there's any code of good practice, because they wanted to know what the trending were so that they could make informed decisions about the treatments back in the 80s and 90s. You know, so it's always been done, and that's for good husbandry, as, you know, as one would with, well, you know, in other sectors.
When you said, and I noted it down because it caught my attention, what is the, you talked about the risk of lowering the sea lice burden, that being a risk.
Exactly.
What do you mean by that?
It would mean that if the sea lice threshold burden for us to then intervene was lower, that means we would have to then intervene and do a treatment on a population of fish which is not for their welfare. So it's not right. Their interest. So that will end up resulting in the potential, or it certainly results in a higher risk of harm and potential for mortality. So, you know, so that is what we're concerned about, that whereas it's not for their own benefit, it's for a perceived benefit of a potential risk against transfer of sea lice to wild salmon.
And just to add, if I may, if you take a wild adult salmon in the sea, or when it enters a river, it will often have sort of 10 plus sea lice on it. So it's normal for maturing fish to have that level. If you're arguing that for salmon it should be pushed down to zero, then you're forcing a level of treatment regime which will elevate mortality and compromise welfare. And that's why we felt that when we did the Salmon Interactions Working Group, which tried to take the heat out of the situation between the wild sector and the farm sector, a model which predicted, if the burden is so high at a certain level on farms and smolts, very simply, are swimming through that estuary or pathway, what is the appropriate level, so you don't over-treat and compromise welfare, but you don't let levels rise on the farm where they could provide a hazard. So very, very sensible. And I think the risk framework that's come in has largely done that. It's showed that out of 250 or so farms, only 19 have a potential for impact. And that's a good thing. We should just make sure that that model is as accurate as possible, because to Ralph's point, if you don't, if you just keep going for absolutely no risk whatsoever and over-enthuse on the precautionary principle, which they do, then you end up with a model which forces treatment of livestock, which is counterproductive to welfare.
I understand that, but what about the salmon farms that you mentioned there, where there is a no deterioration policy? Do you not believe that that, for them, is a standstill policy and does nothing then to support the objectives of improving the environment?
I think, well, most, as I mentioned before, most of the farms are with the company Maori that I work for, some with other companies here. So we feel that provided the model is validated and made accurate, and you've identified a very small number of farms that could potentially, at certain parts of the year, provide a level of sea lice which would become a hazard, not to cause mortality, but to cause undesirable behaviour in wild smolts. We don't want that. So then honing in on those farms and changing the farming situation, so changing the cycle time or putting larger smolts to sea so you can cut off, or being fallow when the wild smolts go out, I think that's a progressive system. And I think the industry and CEPA and the Interactions Working Group are on something that will improve the situation. But you just need to watch for, you know, fisheries interests making sure that there is ultra precaution, because then the model becomes unrealistic in its output.
Okay, so just before I bring Kimberly
Rachel,
in.
Can I bring in Kimberly? She wanted to come in the back of your last question.
Yeah, sure, thanks.
Yeah, sorry, I just wanted to add that the industry sea lice figures at the moment are the lowest they have been in the last 5 years, and certainly within Bakkafrost we have to look back a decade to see lice figures as low as that we currently see. And as Ralph was saying, you know, if we get pressed into lower and lower thresholds, this takes away some of the veterinary decision making that is currently in place to ensure the welfare of the fish. So there has to be a balance there. I think that's really important.
Yeah. Sorry, very briefly. I mean, I live in an area where there, and we operate our farms in an area where there are no wild salmon in Shetland and Orkney, and that needs to be taken into account. I think if there's national legislation comes in, it would need to take into account the fact that there are differing situations in different places.
Rachel.
Okay, so do you, just to develop the conversation, the answer from Ben Hadfield, obviously you talked there about the compromising of the fish health. Professor Martin also talked about breaking the life cycle of sea lice. Do you think that, obviously, CEPA are rolling out this regulatory framework, and we won't see sort of that whole full rollout, I don't think, until 2027. Do you believe that as things develop, because I've learnt a lot today in terms of, you know, how things are changing because of the climate and other aspects, do you think that some of the framework will adapt to take into account the issues that we are seeing and include things like measures to break the life cycle of sea lice within that, and what salmon farms are doing?
Yeah, so they already exist. Most salmon farmers will fallow an individual site and fallow a sort of hydrographic area with a contiguous fallow to break the lice. You know this. So the model, if it is developed in a robust, validated, scientific way, will become an important tool to answer the question, does the lice level on the farms have a potential risk to wild fish? And I think that's incredibly important. So we should not get into a situation, because there's a game that's being played here with the wild fish sector and the activists to make the model architecture as ultra precautionary as it can be, so it prevents farming in certain locations. And personally, I don't think that's wise. I think we should use the model to make sure we've got the most robust prediction of potential hazard to wild fish, and then manage the farms by changing the farming cycle or relocating the farm closing that farm down and expanding elsewhere. And I think that's the goal, really, of most enlightened people that are involved in the model's development.
OK, just one last question.
Briefly.
Yep. Do you believe, I mean, don't know if anyone can answer this, but do you believe that it is right that new farms should not be granted authorisation, particularly if they are not reaching these standards? I mean, what are your views on the sea lice numbers in some places that are just, they're not getting on top of it?
I'm sorry if I answered all the questions, but I'm a bit of a geek in this area. The model itself now is in place, and it prevents any farm being developed or expanded in an area where it would have a potential hazard to wild fish, with a model architect which massively overpredicts the effect to a scale of about 4 or 5. And so I think the model shouldn't overpredict, and the model should be accurate, because we're talking about wealth creation and jobs here, and having a vibrant industry. But I like the safeguards in the model that's now in place.
I think that, can I just add to that? It's a very fair question. I think the other side to that is the point we were discussing earlier on with your committee, which is the consenting regime needs to adapt and change to take this into account as well. So our desire, some of our companies across the piece would like to look at different sites and different areas in deeper water, for example, and more exposed sites. That all plays exactly to your question, Rachel Hamilton, and we need that progress on that consenting regime. So if the committee is minded to agree with that, that would be really helpful for us too.
Thank you.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. Fisheries Management Scotland told the committee that it's continuing to receive reports about escaped juveniles from freshwater farms appearing in rivers, but yet no escapes have been reported to the Fish Health Inspectorate. Can I ask if you can explain the discrepancy and what actions is the industry taking to prevent the escapes?
Yeah, so I'll answer the specifics of that case towards the end, but for context and as quickly as I can, as part of the interactions working group to bring the two sectors together, farm fish and wild fish, we agreed that we would make a rapid transition to the strongest possible containment standards, the Norwegian technical standard or the Scottish technical standard, so that a lot of the equipment holding farm fish was upgraded very quickly, and I think that's culminated in the fact that you see the escape levels drop massively to like one fish out of all the fish that are held in Scotland. The specific situation that is referred to by FMS is on the River Shin, where it's not my company, but I've been involved in discussions. There is no reported escapes. There are two farmers within the Loch Shin, and the Fisheries Trust is finding farm smolts in the river. And I think all three bodies have got to come together much more quickly and find a way of identifying the smolts from one farm or marking them. And you can mark them with various biomarkers and put that in place, and then make sure that the containment standard is as good in that area as it has been in the rest of the industry of late.
OK, but they didn't know that the fish had escaped. They didn't report it.
So it's a legal requirement to know that an escape has taken place or that you have suspicion of escape. There are two companies farming in Loch Shin. They're not doing that, so they almost certainly don't know if it's taken place, but the Fisheries Board are finding what they think are farm smolts. So I think the logical step is for both companies to agree some form of marker and improve the containment standards even further. Then if farm fish are found in the river, they can be traced back to the farmed source.
Okay. Can I briefly ask what improvements are being made? I'll not say technological. Oh, there we go. When I didn't think about it. On marine cages to address some of the escapes. Connie.
So, I mean, there's been a variety of innovations that we've put in place to reduce fish escapes. It goes down to just basic farm handling, where you'll stretch a net between a boat and a pen, thus creating almost like a protective sort of barrier as you transfer fish across. I mean, that's simple scale, everyday farming practice to minimise fish escapes there. We've also increased our capacity to to net check. So look underneath the water. As you can imagine, it's hard to see what's going on underneath, but it's vitally important that we understand what the condition of our nets are. So we've improved our practices through the use of ROVs, our change in net material to more sturdier Seal Pro nets. Our net cleaners have got cameras on them, so as they're cleaning the pens, they're also assessing the nets to look for any potential damage. We use nets such as EnviroNets, which is basically two nets stitched together, and you'll swing the pens so the fish stay where they are. But in doing that, you're actually manually assessing the pens, so the fish farmer is looking at that. Cameras, just feed cameras, ROV cameras, give us greater understanding of what's going on. We also service our nets, and they get strength tested between cycles. So that sort of key containment area, the net in which the fish are in, it goes under rigorous sort of observation to ensure that it's strong enough to withstand the environment in which it is in. And there are other examples. That's just a small selection.
Thank you. We're going to move on to theme six, which fits fish health and animal welfare, and kick off with Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. The REC committee recommended that no expansion should be permitted at sites which report high or significantly increased levels of mortalities. Mortalities continue to be a problem. So what is the industry learning from incidents of high mortality, and how are those lessons being applied to actions to prevent recurrence?
Well, I think it would be fair to say, Convener, we spent nearly the whole morning on this, and we've answered heaps of questions on mortality, and we've explained at great length all the technological, to your word, and technological changes and innovations that the industry is investing in. It's a very fair question, but I think we've really, in terms of time, we've pretty well done that one to death. I mean, we are very confident we've moved this industry enormously forward. That's why we've spent nearly £1 billion on fish health and welfare, to absolutely Emma Roddick's very fair point, and we're in a much different place than we were now. And also mortality levels this year, I think, is one of, I forget now who mentioned it, significantly lower this year. And we're very proud of that. It's good progress.
Okay, so in 2023, the Fish Health Inspectorate data showed 17 million salmon deaths, which was the most ever recorded. 2022 before that had also been record-breaking. You're expecting the figures this year to be drastically improved?
Well, they are improved. But we also explained, Emma Roddick, you ask a fair question, we also explained, I think at some considerable length, why that was. And we can go over it again, Convener, if you want, but I'm very conscious that we really have, I think, answered that very fully already.
I think if Emma's got some specific points which you would like to
course,
go over again.
Of course, very happy to. Yeah.
So I would like to dig more into welfare, because we've heard a few times today mortality is just one and possibly not the most important indicator that you use of fish welfare. I'm aware that the welfare standards used by fish farms are the same as those for land-based animals being farmed. What is the reason behind that? Do you believe that it is a good enough indicator of welfare? One of the standards is that animals should be allowed to conduct their instinctive behaviours. Could you describe what those are for salmon and how they're able to do them in a cage?
Sure, very good question. Ben, do you want to have a first cut at that? Or what should we put that to? Kimberly. Let's start Kimberly.
Yes, so being able to enact the natural behaviour, obviously salmon are a schooling animal, so they'll swim around in a shoal with members of the cohort of the same species. So they are, in fact, taking part in that natural behaviour every day. We supply them with all other aspects of welfare, so we're feeding them an appropriate diet. We are feeding them to an appropriate level, and that's well monitored using cameras and feeding operatives. We have already discussed at great length about the treatment interventions to make sure that their health is maintained. We're using novel diagnostic techniques to pick up presence of pathogen very, very early so that we can intervene and we can take management decisions at the earliest possible point. And we've just spoke about escapes and containment and how we're keeping predators out of the cages as well. So I think all of the aspects of welfare, the five freedoms, have been well covered in some of the other questions this morning.
But we can expect within a farm that one in four salmon will die early. Is that good enough welfare? And do you believe that salmon living in cages currently do have high welfare standards?
Yes, absolutely. If you look at the survival of farmed salmon compared to wild salmon, it's massively higher. That's because they're cared for, they're given feed, they're protected from predation. But we're not in any way satisfied that mortality has come up in Scotland over the last decade. We want to reduce that.
Okay.
So to go into, I think the question you're asking is, you know, would you stock a farm with 500,000 fish and then have a mortality event and then decide, okay, let's put more in next time? We that's not the way we operate. You know, we try and balance the stocking level to the best possible outcome for welfare and growth. And there's no way that you just try and solve a problem by stocking more fish on the site. But you can have a situation in salmon farming where an area has always produced great fish, and then suddenly you get a toxic algal bloom that washes in from the open ocean, or jellyfish mm-hmm. that cause 80% plus mortality overnight. That can occur.
Okay, the fish health plan was raised earlier, and I was grateful to Salmon Scotland for circulating it ahead of our visit a couple of weeks ago. Very little space in the document is actually given over to fish health. And before you get to the commitments, you have to read quite a lot about the economic benefits of salmon farming and the number of jobs that it sustains. Is there a reason that the focus of the fish health plan is not fish health?
I would respectfully suggest that's not the case. I forget now how big the document is, but there's lots and lots in there, Ms. Roddick, about fish health. Could we change the order? If you'd like it to change the order, we'll change the order. But we're genuinely trying to help the committee with a lot of information. We provided heaps of information again this morning on all this, and I think any suggestion that we're not absolutely passionate about fish health could be further from the truth. I don't know if any of my colleagues want to speak to that, David.
No, just very brief. It comes back to what I said earlier on. It's almost like the question is, it's almost as if we don't care. I mean, how on earth don't we care? I mean, we look after these animals. We do care for them. We give our staff training in welfare training, how to, everybody is trained in that. And people come in to work for us who, like people like me, who have been crofters our whole lives, who do have an intrinsic understanding of animals and care for their welfare. I mean, we really do care. It almost feels like you feel that we don't, and that could not be further from the truth.
You've got to remember that, you know, some of the interests in the wild fish sector and some environmental activists, they are stakeholders, and we give them respect. But they have conned onto this message. It's a very sticky but a very false message that mortality occurs in salmon farming because they're doing it badly. You know, they're overstocking, and it's a very sticky message, but it's absolutely false. The way that you make money in salmon farming and have a good, vibrant business is to improve growth, drive down mortality, and increase the average weight. And you've got to understand that. So everything that we do, as David says, is about trying to prevent mortality and get the best possible welfare in place. And I think we've been incredibly transparent and open about how difficult that's been in the Scottish marine environment over the last few years.
I would want to clarify.
I think we are revisiting statements that we've already heard. So we can just, if we can try and, if there's any new information we need, that would be helpful. I appreciate where you're going, but we are getting the same responses.
Yeah, I would clarify. I'm not suggesting that any individual doesn't care. What I'm recognising as a fact is that documents which were sent to this committee on fish health initially were about economic impact. That is what was given to us, and it wasn't my creation. The commitments within it, which incidentally don't feature in the condensed version, include one to introduce, where appropriate, long-term strategic changes to how we farm our fish. What long-term strategic changes have been brought in since the publication of the plan?
Well, the publication of the plan was a summation, Ms. Roddick, which I think we explained to you on Bacold in the other week, just the other week, of everything we're doing and what we're going to do. So the plan is very live right now. So it's an active document. But far more importantly than what I may think of a plan or what you may interpret in the terms of the plan, is the actual action all of our companies are taking, which we've talked at for 3 hours about this morning. And we've demonstrated in terms of money and investment and the care for our fish that David's just talked about time and time again. So I think we've laid all that out. I'm not quite sure I'm understanding the concern here, because we've done our very best to provide
bring
that.
Bring in Ralph here.
To respond specifically to that, your question. So So one of the key changes we've done in the actual farming strategy and fundamentals has been actually the use of investment of freshwater facilities, these recirculated aquaculture centres, mm-hmm. which basically are able to control the growth of control the conditions that affect growth of salmon whilst they're in freshwater, such as temperature and light, and also then protect our fish from predators, to allow them to have exceptional quality when they get transferred to sea, and also at a larger than size. And that larger size means that therefore they'll be at sea for potentially at least 2 months less than they would otherwise have been from traditional methods. 2 months less time at sea, that then also means that they'll be facing less environmental challenges, which means that then they will be using less potential veterinary medicines, which means that there'll be less also discharge, so there's potential, you know, within the environment, even though that it has been assessed as being does not cause any significant harm of any of our farms. So certainly, you know, that is a fundamental change since 2018, where a number of the producers now have invested tens and tens of millions of pounds in these facilities. So that's one. And I could go on, Convener.
Connie.
Here's just a brief addition to what Ralph was saying. I mean, these investments like larger fish going to the sea, broodstock facilities, looking at the future of salmon farming, it's not a quick thing to do. So when we talk about long-term investment, they are examples, larger fish in the sea, broodstock development, where we can see the future benefits, but it is just seeing the time to get to that point. So that's a couple of examples of how we'll see the longevity in improving welfare.
Thank you. There's also a commitment to undertake a comprehensive review of the Code of Good Practice. Could somebody give more information on that review?
Well, we could write to the committee on that if that's helpful, but there is a review going on. We review it from time to time. That reflects the changes in the sector we've described today at great length, and we'd be happy to furnish the committee with more information on that if that was of interest, Convener.
Timescales and so on would be
certainly
helpful.
Certainly.
Question from Ariane Burgess. And can I just remind everybody that some of the questions will almost certainly have been answered already, so we're just conscious not to repeat the answers and the responses we've had. Thanks, Ariane.
Thanks very much, Convener. The committee has heard growing evidence that warmer sea temperatures due to climate change are a key cause of increased mortality and fish health issues. And obviously this morning we've been discussing the detail of that at length. So bear with me, because it's not quite, that's the opening. We would be interested to hear whether open-net fish farming has a long-term future, given sea temperatures are predicted to continue to increase, or will the industry need to move to semi-closed or closed containment?
The answer is yes. Open net sea pen farming will continue.
I've got another question based on the same sort of topic from Emma Harper, and then I'll bring
it. I will be really quick. I know, Ben Hadfield, you mentioned stocking density has been less in Scotland compared to Norway, and it's on the back of the sea temperatures. Are you looking at reducing the stocking density because of the changes in temperature to the waters?
Yeah, I think everybody has already done that. So the numbers quoted, the 15 kilos a cubic metre, that's the maximum. I think most people, given the increased water temperature, have tried to go through the summer at you know, 5 to 10 kilos. To Emma Roddick's point, just to give the fish chance to choose where they want to be within the pen. You know, at that point, there's so much room. They're just a shoal within a massive pen. So we have had to have additional capacity to give the fish a lower stocking density.
And just a quick question around, you already mentioned like post-smolt, so that salmon spend less time in the open pens or in like one summer instead of two.
Correct.
So that's something that I see that Maui have just released the first post-smolts in Loch Etive to the island of Muck. So that's something that the industry is looking at adopting more widely.
I think we can all speak to that, certainly. All of our companies can speak to that. So yes is the short answer. There's a longer one.
Yeah. And I'll try and do it really quickly. So basically, if you can hold the fish on land or in an area where they're not subject to these summer pressures, in our case, Loch Etive, in other people's cases, on land, then it looks like you can reduce mortality by up to 50% by having only one summer at sea. So that's an obvious goal that everyone's chasing down.
Yeah, sorry, we look, at Cook we looked through something similar to what Maui are doing in Loch Etive. We're looking, targeting what we call nursery sites, sites that, which have smaller fish, but have a fish when they first go to sea, and then we move them into what we call grower sites later. So.
To Applecross, but you may want to just corroborate the point that I was asking about.
Yeah. Absolutely, with the goal of putting larger, more robust smolt out to avoid having two high-risk periods in the sea. It avoids that challenge of micro jellyfish, plankton, everything else, high water temperatures in that second season where the fish are at slightly higher risk. So, yes.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, I've got a brief supplementary from Christine.
In fairness, and this is not to, you know, in any way attack on you during your presentation as witnesses, but someone has sent something in supplementary to my question about mortalities at Dunstaffnage. And I think in fairness to you, because this is circulated, you get the opportunity to answer it. They say they decided to check the figures of mortalities on the government's website and so on and so on. To be brief, it says that the last time the publication of figures is very slow. Nothing has been posted since June 2024. They attach a spreadsheet. The short cycle is puzzling. I'm quoting now. The short cycle is puzzling and the operators should be asked to explain. It looks as if 706 tonnes of reasonably mature salmon have been brought in from elsewhere and survivors removed after very high mortalities. Close quotes. I'm not saying that's the case. I'll give you the opportunity to answer.
Thank you. That's really appreciate the point. Could we just ask who is saying this?
I don't think it's appropriate that I give the name just now because it's not authorised. I mean, I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I just think please answer it. You know,
and well,
if
I'm
you can't
sure
now,
we do,
write
I'm not
an
sure
answer. Because this is being
detail,
taken from HTTPS aquaculture.scotland.gov.uk/data
convener,
data submission,
if
so
the committee would like to write to us on
you
this,
have it on the
respond.
Record, so in fairness
yes,
to you,
I totally
because that's going to be you know, it's going to be out there, is to give you the chance to answer this. And
sure.
I'm sure the convener will be happy
I
to
totally
forward this
that.
To you.
We'll write back.
I think the question's all about whether the rates of mortality and whatever are also taken in consideration. There may be high volumes of fish brought into
yes.
the farm during a cycle. So we're not going to put you on the spot at
no.
the moment because you obviously don't have the figures in front of you that we've got. So we will write and hopefully
thank
we can respond
you.
To that
thank
in
you.
The future.
I should put you, because it'll be recycled round everybody.
Thank
yeah.
you. Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. I'm keen to ask a little bit around wrasse. The Fish Health Inspectorate told the committee that its primary concern was that the mortality of cleaner fish is higher than it would like. The committee is also aware of concerns regarding the sustainability of wild wrasse fisheries. How are you responding to those concerns and what action is being taken by industry to improve the welfare of these fish?
Connie, do you want to...
Thank you. I can answer on the cleaner fish. So we've put a lot of investment into how we manage the cleaner fish stock on site, and we talk about these new state-of-the-art well boats that are being developed and rolled out. And these systems all have a dewatering system, and basically it allows the cleaner fish, the wrasse or the lumpfish, to fall through the bars and be sort of pumped into a holding tank to then be returned to the pens. So it means it directs them away from actually going into the well and back into the pen. So it gives that level of divide. Only that is, you know, there's a lot of effort based at the farms in recapturing the cleaner fish prior to treatments to prevent them sort of passing through the treatment. We put hides and additional enrichment, so they're not just put into cages and left. You know, we are also looking after them, so we're putting in kelp or barrels, depending on the different species of which are at each farm. We also have a specific diet, so the diet has changed, and we now use one by World Feeds, and it's tailored to cleaner fish rather than a more universal diet. So we're looking at the nutrients in which they need. It also comes with a very clever feeding mechanism that allows you to know that you need to restock the feed block. I think also when you talk on wild fish, particularly wrasse, that we're capturing them. I mean, all the wrasse fishermen that are used, they all require licences from Marine Scotland.
Yes.
So they have to go through that policy and they have to record their data and they have to give their data to Marine Scotland, but we're also investing in facilities that farmed wrasse, so we can produce farmed wrasse to then further reduce our reliance on wild caught. And as we progress with that, our numbers of wild catch will decrease.
So there are concerns about the sustainability then if the industry is trying to move to not wild caught?
I think it gives us greater control. You know, you want to have control over what you're putting into the pens. You know, you always want to reduce your impact on the environment. And by having this facility, you know, we can further reduce, it's part of being sustainable, reduce where we can. And that is a factor of reducing pressures on the environment.
Just to augment, like any fishery, there's a sustainable maximum that you can fish from. And we're not clear where that is in terms of wild wrasse, but what the companies have done is started to farm wrasse so that you don't need to take from the wild.
And we've also, to that point, we've also funded a PhD study into this with Aberdeen University to exactly that point, to try and understand this more fully with academic partners.
Ralph?
Just a bit in perspective. A scientific report produced by a paper by Marine Scotland Science in 2016, which we can forward on the reference of, which estimated the quantity of wrasse that was consumed by seals just in the wild. And that was 3,454 tonnes. And by otters, it was 400 tonnes. The annual volume of wrasse, which is wild harvested for our sector, is between 40 and 90 tonnes, to put that in perspective. From Scotland.
Yeah, those being eaten by seals and other aquatic life, that's natural, right? That's not being used to farm
That's just
for
nature.
Human.
But what we probably should have said is before they were used in farms, they were actually used as bait for lobster pots.
Yeah.
Where we want to be is, you know, a scientifically sustainable level of catch from the wild, and then an increasing amount of farmed wrasse, which is where we're going to get to. And in the next couple of years, I think we'll be there.
Okay. I am aware that wrasse struggle more with the likes of freshwater treatment than salmon do, and it's just not possible to fully separate them before such treatments. Is that fair to the wrasse? Is that not a welfare concern?
Well, I think Connie described the mechanisms where we are achieving that separation, Connie, right?
But it is a welfare concern.
Yeah.
So we try and remove as many as the wrasse as possible before the freshwater treatment takes place. The new well boats that have been designed have a system to grade off the wrasse, take them through another treatment system, because they also have AGD, amoeba gill disease, on the gills, and you don't want to treat the salmon, get to zero, and then pop the wrasse back in them. So you want it to treat both at the same time. So again, it's just high-paced innovation, high-paced investment, but it's coming for that reason.
Just one final question, Convener. Throughout this session, we have had disagreements on statistics, yet we've also heard that data being published around mortality and fish welfare is robust. Can that be the case if the committee is receiving one set of data from the Fish Health Inspectorate this week, which is now being challenged by yourselves on mortality? Is that robust data?
I'm not sure we're challenging the Fish Health Inspectorate in any way on anything. I mean, they're figures of what we provide. So you're right, you're absolutely right on your principle, which is we want consistent data and we're usually accountable for that in terms of the regulations that we fish under. But and that's a very fair point. But I don't think there's any difference between us and the Fish Health Inspectorate in terms of what you describe.
Earlier, I quoted from the Fish Health Inspectorate letter that it was 0.55 mortality the week of the visit, and yourselves have said 0.29, so that is a discrepancy, yes?
I think that was because of the reporting period. I think that was answered, that the Fish Health Inspector didn't report the full week.
On that week it did?
No, that was...
They wrote the letter. They sent the letter on the 27th of September, which is on a Friday. So the working week is from Monday to Sunday, so that wouldn't have included the mortality from the weekend as well.
Yeah. But that wasn't the most recent week in the letter.
Okay, sorry. I'd need to come back and maybe respond by letter if this is...
Yeah, I think it's probably more a discrepancy in what we think we're talking about rather than actual discrepancies. But we can follow that up with a letter to both yourselves and the Fish Health Inspectorate. I'm going to move on to Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. This question is maybe a wee bit off the wall. You were talking earlier on about jellyfish and the impact that they have. And that brought me in mind of a similar situation which has been resolved elsewhere. The cross-party group on space, which I'm convener of, discussed this very same problem in relation to power stations. Power stations require satellite tracking of jellyfish, so they get days of knowledge that they're coming down the line so that they can prepare and close up to prevent the jellyfish being taken into their intake ducts. And apparently that's very simple technology already in place. Would something like that not be useful for the salmon industry so that you have knowledge days in advance of where the jellyfish are and where they're coming from, their migratory routes, everything will be tracked, and you'll have plenty of time to prepare?
I can answer this one. So the jellyfish that we're talking about are micro jellyfish. So it's hard to see them using satellite imagery. They're tiny. They're probably smaller than a pinhead, basically. So to be able to track that using satellite image is incredibly challenging. We can use satellite imagery for things like plankton and plankton blooms, and there is some websites and information which we can use from that. You know, cloud cover often makes it quite challenging to see that, and given we're in Scotland, there's quite a bit of cloud cover. But the micro jellyfish in which we're talking about are a lot harder to see. You don't see the bloom in quite the same way as you would see with like a large common jellyfish or a barrel jellyfish, which can be significant, 30 centimetres, easy to see in large blooms. These micro jellyfish require us to take a mill of water, and within that mill of water you could see a couple or maybe 30 jellyfish underneath that. So it's quite hard to fundamentally track that with satellite imagery.
The point that was made was that jellyfish tend to go in, for want of a better word, a cloud. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a whole pack of them together. Therefore, in the aggregate, they can track almost anything. That's what they boast. They can track almost anything. But
can I bring in Kimberley and then Ralph?
Yeah, I think what you're referring to is the big blooms of moon jellyfish. They occur in like many, many thousands, and you can clearly see them from satellites and all the rest. The micro jellyfish that we're talking about, specifically the one that's been the most harmful to the industry, is almost completely transparent. So it's very, very difficult to see even under the microscope. But some of the other tools that we are looking at, things like eDNA, so we can find indicator species that might give us a heads up that there's a bloom of something else coming in a couple of weeks down the line, might help us to get to the point that you're looking at, you know, a sort of early warning system, so to speak, to understand what the patterns might be in the future months.
Ralph, or does that cover it?
What we look for is really clear water, because sometimes when the micro jellyfish are blooming, then that high density is that they've eaten all the phytoplankton, and then the water is really clear and it looks great, but it's not. So you're right in what you say. This can be developed further.
Thank you. Right, our final theme is planning consent. Kick off with Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I will be really quick. The Griggs Review identified issues around planning and consenting, so I'm wondering if the industry has seen an improvement in creating a streamlined, flexible, adaptive planning and consenting, and that would be related to resiting away from migratory routes for wild salmon, but also resiting, is it streamlined enough if there is a fish health issue in certain pen sites?
Yeah, I think we're disappointed that one of the recommendations that was, as you say, hasn't been acted quickly by the regulators. So there isn't a mechanism where you can identify a site where you can make a series of environmental or economic gains by relocating it. And there's not a process for that. So in the absence of it, companies have created their own process and proposed things through the existing system. So having that set up quickly and acted upon as a recommendation would be beneficial.
Okay. Yep.
Have you got another question on migratory routes?
Not really. It was kind of rolled in. I rolled my questions in, but I think it sounds like planning needs to be enabled to achieve aims of moving pens if needed.
So again, a brief question. We're aware that there's a desire or potential in the future for salmon farms to move further offshore, which will reduce some of the environmental impacts that you've very well set out during this session, which will obviously lead to the need for more automation because of how uncomfortable it will be for humans to operate further out to sea. So how will you ensure the welfare of fish if we need to have that additional automation to continue to monitor fish health and well-being?
So maybe on this, David's company are already doing this, and I think that probably the answer is technology and cameras, but David, you can speak to it much more.
Yeah, basically, on the Isle of Westray up in Orkney, then we've moved some sites further offshore, and this has come to the ability to do this has come to technical improvements in terms of and also better the understanding of the modelling of the sea conditions that are out there, tidal conditions, and we put a wave rider buoys and before anything goes out there, there's a full analysis is done into the moorings of the site to ensure it will be able to sustain what is going on out there. We seek to look after those fish the same as we seek to look after any other fish we have in any sites. We invest in boats that are capable of looking after the fish out there, and I can see no reason why we wouldn't be able to look after the fish as well as any others.
Okay, thank you. Edward Mountain.
Ah, finally. I thought I was going to get all my questions, Convener, when Tavish was out of the room, but I'm glad he's back because he's going to get some of them. I'd like to go to start off with, if I may, Convener, to Ben Hadfield. And if I may, Ben, if I could take you mentally, if not, I can't take you physically back to the 2nd of May 2018, a date no doubt that you will have looked back on because you were in the committee, in the Rec Committee with Scott Lansborough and yourself talking about salmon farming. And I think Scott said it was a difficult and challenging environment, but it was getting better. And in fact, I think, to paraphrase your words, Ben, there was a perfect storm of mortality, increased temperature, resistance to medication. But mortality will decrease at sea, and you'll get it to sub 5%. Was that wishful thinking? And if it wasn't wishful thinking, are we going to be sticking at 25%? How long are we going to be sitting between 20 and 25% mortality at sea? Ben.
Yeah, so Edward Mountain's question is fair, but what we've presented today is that sea lice levels are drastically reduced, escapes are drastically reduced. Antibiotic has never been a major issue in aquaculture since the 90s. It's massively reduced and under control when we're developing vaccines. So I'm particularly proud of all the successes that this industry has. I understand your negativity. I think much of it is misplaced. But we have had a very troubling rise in surface seawater temperatures, and that has caused mortality of farm salmon to become elevated. It has also incidentally caused mortality of wild salmon to become seriously elevated, as I firmly believe that the biggest challenge for wild salmon in the British Isles is climate change. And I don't think we gain anything by suggesting that all the companies here are not focused on absolutely delivering
better. With respect, trends. Ben, I haven't mentioned wild salmon. I haven't been negative. I asked you a comment based on your comment to the Rec Committee on the 2nd of May, whether you thought that it was a reasonable comment to make. And if it was, how long do you think we will be at 20 to 25%? I never mentioned sea lice. I don't accept sea lice are the biggest problem you're facing. There are other problems, if you made clear this morning. So, will you answer how long you think the industry will be sat at 20 to 25% mortality of fish at sea? And please don't think I'm being negative. I tried in the last committee meeting to stop a moratorium going forward, and that's what happened. So, give me a little bit of leeway, Ben.
Yeah, I do try. I think we are focused on bringing the level of mortality down. I think if we could achieve what we had post amoebic gill disease in 2012, which was 10 to 15%, at least in the sector I'm familiar with, I think that would be a major achievement. I sometimes get a little tense when sometimes a question is phrased like you're asking an arable farmer what he's going to do to improve the situation in a drought, you know, and we are trying incredibly hard to farm fish in the best possible way with all the innovation we can, and I think we're making progress, but we're obviously disappointed when one of our KPIs is out of kilter. It's not good. So on sea lice it's down, on escapes it's down, on CO2 emissions it's down. This industry is a very sustainable industry. We can make it better by reducing the mortality, and that's what we're focused on doing.
But Ben, Maori would be doing budgets for the next 10 years, and those, but I would suggest, if they're like any other business, and I'm trying to work out how long you're budgeting to have 20 to 25% mortality at sea. And I accept the industry's made changes, and I was delighted to go to Backfrost, and I'll put it on the record, and see the wonderful hatchery that they are developing at Kishorn. And I was grateful for that, and I was grateful for the knowledge that gave me. Mm. I'm trying. Try and answer my question, please, Ben.
Yeah, so specifically, we're budgeting to see a modest reduction in mortality annually now in the region of about 2% going forward over the next 5 years, 2% per year, bringing us back down to those levels. We want to achieve it through expanding the treatment resource, what we discussed at length today in terms of fresh water, through using post-smolt, and through all the innovation that we have. And, you know, that's the main ask of anyone that's employed by all these companies that are before you today.
Okay. That's helpful. So by you're saying in 10 years' time we should be down to about 15% mortality. And don't get me wrong, I know no one wants to lose a fish. I'm a farmer. I don't want to lose a calf. I don't want to lose anything. And I understand the care that goes into doing it.
Yeah.
Because also it's your bottom line that it affects.
Yeah, of course.
But I'm asking you by 10 years' time, we'll be down to 15%. Is that what you're saying?
I'm saying that we put all plans and effort in place to achieve that journey, yes.
Okay, my next question is a general one, just on sea lice. I tend to agree with you. I don't think sea lice are as much as a problem as they were, and I acknowledge the industry's taken huge efforts to do it. The problem is where people feel that they're a problem is you put your smolts to sea having vaccinated them and treated them in preparation for going to sea when they're at their most vulnerable bit, i.e. when they're young and the skin's changing. I think the problem is that wild fish interests may feel that they don't know what happens to the smolts, the wild smolts that go past fish farms, whether they're affected by sea lice, because no one knows what happens to them. They disappear into the wild blue yonder. Do you think as an industry it'd be a good thing to work with those interests to try and iron out that lack of knowledge?
Well, shall I start on that? It's a fair point. We are working with the wild fish industry. We employ, or John Gibb works with us from the Lochie, and you're aware of that, Mr. Mountain. And John is a really experienced fisheries manager, widely known and respected across the sector. And he's super for us because he helps us make the contacts, I think, that you would expect us to make. And some of this is quiet discussion rather than maybe on the front page of the Loch Arbour paper or any other, dare I say it, never even... Anyway, it's quiet diplomacy, and that's the way I think we're making steady progress. Is there more to be done? Yes, of course there is. I think I referenced earlier on that I thought a couple of the things that the FMS official Management Scotland had said to the committee in their letter, I think of this week, were really helpful. I agreed with them. So I think there's a strong desire to see people coming together to work together. And you're right, some of the things we don't understand about the marine environment and don't know, and it's in our interest to find that out as well.
So it's that bit, in my mind, that the wild smolts travel out to sea and they're in the coastal range before they get out beyond that and are clear of the sea lice that we don't know about. So, I mean, I welcome that.
So we have the West Coast Tracking Project, which we'd be happy to send you details about. I'm not sure we learned that much from it, if I may be blunt, and we helped to fund that as well as the government.
I think we learned some things from Tracking Project, and I think David would probably reflect there are wild salmon near Shetland because some do go up past there on their way north. Tavish, on the point that you made when you came in here, if I may, you were quite aggressive to those people that challenged you. Do you think it's right that people have an ability to challenge you and question whether what the industry is doing is right, because you are pretty forceful against them.
I absolutely accept that we have stakeholders who have got every right to say what they like. I have the absolute right on behalf of the 12,000 people I represent to point out that anti-salmon farming campaign organisations are here to put us all out of a job. And actually, Mr Mountain, the thing I think you should be worried about as a cattle farmer, because my daughter is as a sheep farmer, is once they have got rid of us, they then move on to farming. So those are the groups of people that I really do believe we need to call out. And I think we need the committee's support in recognising this is a great industry. It does great things for Scotland. It employs a lot of people all over our country. We're very proud of that. We're very committed to it. We're very committed to working with your Parliament and with the government of the day on the reforms we absolutely need, and accepting the transparency of our decision making and how we operate our businesses. But we need a little bit of help to push back on the utter nonsense that we're subjected to every single day.
So Tavish, my final point to you is I think I reasonably question you, and I reasonably challenge the industry.
That's right. I agree.
And on the 25th of October at 14:30, when you came into my office, one of your comments, word for word, because it was taken down for me, is the issue is your attitude are at the top of the agenda for the next board meeting. The board are very unhappy with you and willing to take action against you unless you retract your comments in Parliament.
Mr Mountain, as a convener of this committee, you'll know that the convener, when he speaks, you're not speaking. I don't think this relates to the evidence that we are taking at the moment, so I caution you to say something you may regret. We are looking at a report into progress in the salmon industry, not something that happened privately in your office. So unless you've got a line of questioning which relates to the inquiry, I would ask you to move on to your next question.
Can I just put on the record, convener, that I didn't know a private discussion was being taped, and I now do.
It was recorded by hand.
I think this is not appropriate at the moment.
I was trying to identify, if I may, that people have a right to challenge the industry and question it, so that we can make the industry come to be the industry that we want it to be in Scotland, and contributing to the export industry that we have. But I find it difficult when I'm being physically or verbally attacked for doing just that, convener. And I'll leave it there, and I apologise if I spoke over you, convener.
Thank you. I had Ralph and Ben indicate they wanted... Ben?
Just to reiterate what I think we all agree is that there are a multitude of stakeholders here, and everybody has the right to criticise aquaculture, to ask questions and expect full transparency. And we strive for that as an industry. There is an obvious tension with salmon anglers and salmon fishing interests. And I come from that background. I'm a keen angler. Tried to find an edge to take the tension down over time. What we need to do is full transparency, pull everything out of the box that we can to tackle mortality, which has risen in difficult environmental conditions. Innovate, keep things like sea lice and escapes to the obviously the lowest level possible, and then just be open and transparent and respect everybody's concerns. And that is what we're focused on doing. And I hope that you've seen that from the committee, from this panel here, although sometimes it's been a little tense.
Yeah, well thank you for that. I think we need to put on record this committee is absolutely committed to ensuring we hear voices from every aspect for and against the salmon industry. And as part of the work we're doing, we will produce a report where we carefully consider all the evidence we've heard, positive and negative, and we'll form our decisions then. I would really like to thank you. We've had an intense, as you say, session that's run quite over time, but hopefully you'll appreciate how important it was to respond to challenges in the media. But I thank you for attending. I'd just like to say the committee had originally planned to conclude its evidence taking at next week's meeting by hearing from the Scottish Government. But unfortunately, due to member availability, that is not going to be able to happen. So we've decided to reschedule the session to a future date, which will be confirmed in due course. I now suspend the meeting for 5 minutes. Our second item of business is consideration of a UKSI consent notification, the official controls, extension of transitional period and plant health, frequency of checks, miscellaneous amendments, regulation 2024. Do members wish to make any comment on this instrument? No. Are members content to agree with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provisions set out in the notification being included in UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Yes. Thank you. That concludes our business in public today, and we'll now move into private session.